What's up, all you loyal listeners? Jonathan here, and thank you for returning for part two of our very first staff picks for Avengers Endgame. Now, if you didn't tune in last week, be sure to go over and start off this entire episode arc with Avengers pregame, where we review the first 21 movies in the Marvel Cinematic Universe in a 30-second little bite-sized game. Then come back to this one and take on the first half of Avengers Endgame. And if you're wondering, hey, why did you stop after that one part? It's because this is going to be a three-parter, and the last part will come out next week. So hold on to your seats, strap in, and let's go into the quantum realm with Avengers Endgame.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a very special episode of Bombs Away.
This is a bonus bomb.
Bonus bomb. It's like the little boy.
What?
You know, big fat man and little boy, the two bombs we dropped in World War II? Read a fucking book.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was a really dark joke.
Yeah, once you revealed it, too, I was like, wow, you shouldn't have gone there.
Yes.
Welcome to the start of this episode.
This is a bonus bomb where we are going to gush and dissect a good movie for once, something I don't think we've ever done on this. And not so bad it's good. No, just so good that it's good.
Yeah.
If you didn't tell from the title of this episode, we are going to be talking about Avengers Endgame.
Yeah.
Yeah. I am Tyler Rowe, joined, as always, in the studio by...
the superhero that you never wanted, Jonathan Young.
And also, special guest joining us, been here a few times.
Once, Peyton Bieber.
There we go.
Once.
That's right, you were on Spider-Man 3,
Spider-Man
right?
Spider-Man 3.
Arguably, maybe the last good movie you guys covered on the show.
I figured it was only appropriate.
It's got its moments.
That we bring this one back for another superhero round.
Heck yeah.
When we do The Avengers from the 90s.
Yes.
That one I want to save for a con. I want to actually do it at a con.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that one and Fantastic Four by Corman's Fantastic Four.
Oh, God.
Yeah, with the
and
kid
Corman's
from Not Quite
Captain
Human.
America.
Oh, yeah, 1991.
When he looks like he's, like, painted on it.
Yeah.
It's so gross.
But.
And his frisbee.
Guess what?
Disc thing.
Yes, what?
I got taglines.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm really thrown off by this dynamic right now.
I know, right?
So weird.
Avenge the Fallen.
That's the one I was on a poster.
Yep.
On a lot of posters.
All 20 of them?
Is there any other tagline other than that?
No, there's more.
Oh, Jesus.
Nothing can prepare you for the end.
Game.
It should have been.
For the end game. And it's Thanos playing chess.
Godzilla.
That's pretty weak. That trailer, that's genuinely a grunt, like a groan moment
that's
in that trailer for me.
The whole trailer is awesome.
Because I was like, wait, is his name Zilla, but he's a god? So like, Godzilla. But then later on, they're like, Godzilla. It's like,
yeah, and what are those separate? Is it like, God damn?
Yeah.
And Zilla.
Also, real quick to touch on that, isn't like, I know it looks like it in the trailer, but isn't Mothra kind of like a good guy?
She's a good guy.
That's right.
Like, you know, the little midget girls inside the clam are.
The telekinesis.
Mothra, come back to us, Mothra. That's good R rolling.
Yeah. I can roll an R like nobody's business.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Don't demonstrate for us.
No.
Just leave it there.
That's it.
Kill everyone for the suspense.
We'll do it later.
The next bonus episode where Jonathan just rolls ours.
And I got one more.
Okay.
Whatever it takes.
That's probably the weakest of all of them.
Yeah, I feel like that one came out after, like on that second round of advertising. Yeah,
no, that second round was the...
Here's the spoilers.
No, the second round was that great, those great character posters.
Oh, yeah.
That said, Avenge the Fallen.
The black and white, and then the color ones.
Yeah, where you found out that, like, certain people were dead that you didn't know because they didn't show them fade away.
Yeah, you're just like, you should just assume they're dead. I thought they showed her die in Infinity War.
No.
I guess I just assumed she died.
Well, to get ready for this, everything that we're doing, I actually rewatched Infinity War, then went to watch Endgame.
Infinity War is so good.
It is.
Also, if you were not anticipating this, sorry, time's up. It's been 3 weeks. This is gonna be filled with spoilers.
Yeah.
So if you're listening and you're like, oh, I haven't seen the movie, first off, what the fuck are you doing?
I think you're the only one in the world?
Yeah.
What is it, like $2 point something billion?
Yes.
Yep. So, you ready?
Yes.
Well, here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, I got some stats for you.
Oh, damn.
You didn't think we could just not do normal things that we would normally do on the show, did you?
I did.
Oh, well.
Special bomb.
Yeah, I got stuff for you. With a budget of $356 million and a cumulative worldwide ongoing gross right now of $2.3 billion.
Wow, I would say that is a gain.
It's a net gross of just a little bit.
That's at least $6 gross.
With a whole bunch of crazy shit that we're about to talk about. And an 8.8 on IMDb and a 91% on Rotten Tomatoes. It's 2019's Avengers Endgame. Let's
praise some. Like,
let's gush about this movie. Welcome to Gush Away.
Yeah. Let's sing its praises.
If you joined us last time, we set out to talk about Endgame and then instead talked about all the other Marvel movies.
We were getting to it.
We were building up hype.
Avengers pregame.
Avengers pregame.
Phases 1, 2, and 3.
Phases 1, 2, and 3. Mm-hmm. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the main event. So, yes, we'll be talking about Avengers Endgame in depth, getting into it. Buckle up. Take a road trip. This is going to be a long one.
I thought the last one was long.
Don't worry about it. Because we're going to use time travel.
What?
So we're basically going back to the happening episode.
We're going to use time travel. Ladies and gentlemen, joining us live in the studio, Callum. Wow, is that Jared as well?
I got nothing.
Oh my gosh.
And Vicente.
Hello.
No, yes, we'll be talking about Endgame.
Shit, could you imagine if we actually went back to old episodes, just jumped into them?
That'd be pretty cool.
And we were like, yeah, that episode, that wasn't funny.
Welcome to the Double Bombs Away.
I don't care what you say. That is Bombs Away's ass.
So, once again, just a little Surgeon General's warning here. If you have
You're
not
die of cancer.
Yes. If you have not seen this movie, it has now been a month when you're hearing this since it came out. So I will say the same thing I did last time.
You're
what the fuck
dumb.
Are you doing?
Why are you listening to this?
The rest of the world is leaving you behind. So go see it.
In the dust.
And if you don't care, that's weird. You can keep listening. And we'll do our best to tell you about it. But we're going to get in depth.
In deep.
Like, yeah.
Deep in Thanos' asshole.
We're going shot by shot.
frame by frame.
Jesus.
There is
a show like that that does it for Super Mario Brothers movie.
Really?
Yes.
Frame by frame?
Scene for scene.
Oh.
But that, yeah.
That's fine.
I love the Super Mario Brothers
No, it's minute
Brothers
by
movie.
Minute. It's every minute. I think they're actually done now.
Oh, like yeah. They, holy crap.
Oh,
that's a lot of
movie?
Episodes.
Huh?
This is one movie?
One movie, that was it.
Oh. Jesus Christ.
They should do another movie. Why are they like,
yeah, right? They just ended it.
Like, yeah, we're done. Yeah.
Well, that's like what? Like 110 episodes? That's a long time for one movie.
Well, it depends on how many minutes they count in an episode.
Well, that's what he's saying. It's just approximating. Like, yeah, if it's an hour 10 movie, then yeah.
Oh,
Yeah. They did a couple bonuses in addition and stuff like that. But yeah, like, I think they did like 10 more after the movie to like kind of wrap it all up. But you're just like, oh, God.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the episode you've been waiting for, the 5-episode arc when Bob Hoskins almost dies. Yes. Yes. So Marvel Endgame, that was a weird one. Avengers Endgame.
Yes.
Let's get into it.
Let's do it.
Let's really quick. What did you think?
What did I think?
I already know how you think. I could hear you from the over there. Like,
well, do we introduce ourselves?
Oh yeah, that's right.
Okay,
ladies and gentlemen, joining me in the studio as always is Mister.
Well, I'm the snap you always wanted, Jonathan Young.
Are you Slim Jim?
Yeah.
Snap into Slim Jim! And joining us once again for this special Avengers Endgame episode is...
Peyton Bieber.
Oh, yeah. Resident Spider-Man enthusiast.
Heck that's yeah. Right. Number one.
How do you... Far from home? I also have to say, we don't give him credit. How it's our production manager for the show, for the live shows.
That is right. Our production manager, Peyton Bieber.
I try to keep it all together. It's kind of hard, but you know.
Yeah.
He's there. He's always saying, why don't we just try to set up the green screen the night before? And we're like, Peyton, listen, buddy, we're flying by the seat of our pants as it is.
Hey, what about like that tech rehearsal? So I'm not like, what do I hit? I don't know. This button. Turn off the lights over there.
Listen, bud, this is, I get here and that's, we're lucky for that.
Yeah.
Yes. And I'm Tyler Rowe, the other guy on the microphone. It might be weird because I did the intro.
Yeah, how does it feel right now?
Feels powerful.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You got the Infinity
I'm like it.
I got the Power Stone.
Oh.
I'm about to just knock the wind out of you and just rock your shit across the battlefield.
Nice.
Yeah.
So it feels good? You wanna keep going with that?
Yeah.
Well, all right.
Jonathan's retiring.
Yeah, yeah.
Jonathan got into Disney Aspire. Now he's put the burden of the podcast on my shoulders. No,
I get into Disney Aspire, then they won't call me.
Oh, shit.
Okay, so, yeah, let's do this.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, Godzilla comes out this week. As
yeah, it hasn't happened.
Out.
Yes. Yeah, 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 cool.
May 30th or something.
Yeah. Aladdin has come out.
Join us next week for when we cover Aladdin.
On a regular bonus.
No regular episode. Yes, I think we're basically keeping these bonus episodes for something actually
not
good.
Like monumental.
Yeah. Yes.
Like this movie.
Well, Star Wars.
My original. Oh, yeah, we can do the overarching thing like we did for this one, you know?
Yeah. We just have to explain them.
Yeah.
But you only get 10 seconds.
Oh, shit.
You got to use sound effects.
Anakin. Next.
Anakin. All right.
It's sand.
Anakin and clones. Next. Anakin, clones, lava. Next.
Yeah.
Episode 5. R2-D2 throws up.
Anakin, end of movie, Rogue One.
Han Solo's there. It was pretty good. Why didn't you go see it? Clint Howard's also there. Han Solo.
They mentioned me again, Mom.
Really racking it up.
They mentioned me in Endgame.
I'm not even in it.
Oh, I was in it.
He's one of those gremlin-ass things.
That... I was the rock monster. But somebody else did the voice. Okay. All right.
So, do you want to... Well, yeah. What did you guys think?
Oh, right off the bat? First impressions?
I just want your, like, yeah, review. What do you get it out of 10?
10.
Oh, 11.
Okay.
Damn.
I'm like at an 8.
It's
you're an 8?
Nah, I'm like a 9.
Okay.
Why 9?
I really liked it. I it's perfect ending to this, but I'm gonna say it. Semi unpopular opinion. Infinity War is like top notch.
Hmm. I think that is a very good contender.
Yes.
I would almost agree with you on that one.
I give Infinity War like a 9.2.
Oh. I would say that this one goes higher for me due to the heart in it.
Yes.
Yeah. There is a lot of heart in Infinity War, though.
There is, but it's because everybody's split up.
Yeah, it is hard to follow.
No,
I mean, never... it's just like, it's not hard to follow. It's just kind of like everyone's all over the place, so they're not all together, so you don't have that, like, ooh.
It, yeah.
That moment, like you had in Endgame.
Yeah. But Infinity War, the action set pieces are much closer together than in Endgame, where they are pretty spread.
I have to say, I do like Infinity War Thanos rather than Endgame Thanos.
See, and that's where I deviate. I really like Endgame Thanos.
Really?
Because he's got nothing to lose.
We'll get into that. Because I'm right there with you, Peyton. Yeah. Like, I don't like this Thanos at all.
Yeah, we'll talk about it. Yeah.
In 4 hours.
Yeah. So you guys want to just roll into this, just like the movie does, because holy shit, that opening scene.
Okay. Crying already.
So we open up with what Hawkeye was doing.
Everyone's least favorite adventure.
Right? Because we have not seen him. That was the big question on everybody's lips of Infinity War was like, where is Hawkeye?
Which is funny because
Scott Lang?
That was explained to you where Hawkeye was in Ultron.
Right, but you wanted to see him show up.
Yeah, but
Or
is it Civil War?
No, it was explained in Infinity War.
When he has a family?
It was like a throwaway line.
Well, I'm talking the first time you see him with his family is Ultron, isn't it?
Right, but basically the question was, where is he halfway through? And somebody, who is it that, it's Bruce. It's Bruce is back in Infinity War from the Ragnarok stories, and they're like, yeah, Civil War happened, and Scott Lang and Hawkeye took a plea deal. It was a very throwaway line.
On house arrest.
Oh, that's why where's the ankle bracelet? Because I forgot.
So I missed the ankle bracelet until this showing that we saw. By the way, guys, we saw this. I saw it three times.
This is my second.
Right.
Second,
so we've all seen it.
And we literally just saw it today a few hours ago. So it's very fresh in our mind. But we will butcher it still.
Yeah. This is the first time I caught the ankle bracelet.
Yeah, I saw it the first time and I was like, what?
I must have been like looking down the first two times at like my pretzel bites. I don't know. Just dipping them in that cheese.
Oh, an ankle bracelet.
Wow, man, if I wasn't stuffing my face, I would have seen it.
Yeah, so he's with his family, which I always thought that was the case, because, like, in Ultron, he's basically like, yeah, yo, I'm done. Like, I got a family now.
Is he like, one more? He's like, all right, last one. I swear, guys, I'm done with this Avengers.
Yeah.
Crap.
Well, maybe, like, a Civil War I could do.
Yeah, that'd be cool. That'd be cool. Yeah, he's teaching his daughter archery way too close to the target. Made me very uncomfortable the entire scene, because, like, if it, like, hits back at them, they're, like, fucked. Velma is making hot dogs for him and his family.
I did not know that was
good
her.
Good job, Sparrow Eye.
I ran out of arrows. Yeah, Linda Cardellini.
I was like, I looked at Twitter afterwards and was like, holy crap, that's her?
I told him to watch, Payne's never seen Grandma's Boy.
Oh my god, yeah she's in that. I am a computer.
Yeah.
Yeah, you gotta see it, dude.
Yeah. So, yeah, they're just practicing and just to get through, because it's not really important. It just is basically, where was Hawkeye? What's happening to him? Is that straight up his entire family disappears from the snap.
And, God, talk about setting the mood for your movie.
Pulling the heartstrings already.
Because what proceeds after this, I would almost argue would be, like, a better beginning. Because that is such a, like, oof.
Yeah.
Like, okay, so here's what's weird to me about this scene, and then going back to, like, Ant-Man and Wasp, when they disappear, too, is that, like, and this is going to be an overarching thing for our episode, right? When you go, the majority audience is hella dumb.
Yeah.
Right? Because I'm over here watching this scene, right? And like, I'm in my mind, I'm like, they're about to get snapped. They're about to fade away.
No,
right?
As soon as I saw the scene, I was like, oh, goodbye, family.
Yeah. Right?
But it opens up, you're like, oh, well.
But every single time I saw this, there were people being like, oh, no.
But I don't know if that's, I don't know if that's a, like, oh, no, I didn't see that coming, or if that's a gen, because it's, I still, every single,
it
the
is,
two,
but
two times I've seen it, I've been like,
but the way
damn.
I heard it, it sounds like shock.
I think it's less shock and more just like, fuck, man, this guy can't catch a break.
Yeah.
His ears don't work. He got no family now.
I don't know, because there's and this is my problem. Like I said, it's an overarching thing that we're going to discuss here, is that, like, I'm like, have most of America not seen a fucking movie before?
Well,
that's where I feel.
I don't think I think you know, as we've said before, we're huge nerds, so we're very much invested in this.
I know.
But you got to remember that there's some people who are just casual moviegoers who just go and see
They only see
things.
Every other movie.
I know. But
or they go and see, like my mom does for the most part, is just like, oh, I just really like that Robert Downey Jr. So
I get that, but I feel like we're at a point in movie making world in which we've had at least 30 years of formula. Right? Mm-hmm. Where you're like, how did you not see some things coming?
Yeah, I guess. But like I said, there is casual moviegoers who are not paying that much attention. And to harken back to my parents, after Infinity War, my parents texted me and were like, we are so confused. And I was like, it laid it out pretty easy. But like, you know, casual moviegoer.
My dad fell
asleep.
He was like, I didn't like it.
No, my mom was like, I don't like it. I was so confused about everything. I was like, yo, it like laid out everything.
Did they watch the other ones before that?
My parents have seen the majority of the movies.
More than you.
Hey, I showed my own.
Yeah.
I knew what was going on.
You got lucky with your choices in the last episode.
No, I got almost every single one I have not seen. Yeah, except Ant-Man and the Wasp.
I'd like to see a couple of Avengers.
Avengers?
Yeah.
Oh, I know enough about it because every single Avengers movie feels like it needs to tell you about the first one. They're like, yeah, remember the only Avengers movie we've made? Not that second one. Forget that one. We don't want to talk about that one.
That used to get really annoying for me in Phase 2 when they would just literally say the word New York.
The New York attack?
Yeah. Talking about 9/11? What?
Yeah, like you'd watch the Daredevil show and they'd be like, yeah, after New York. And I'm like, God damn it, can we stop saying New York just so that you would be like, yeah, we're tied to it. We're tied to it too. Remember us?
Yeah. It's me, Iron Fist. Don't cancel my show.
I got snapped.
Yeah, really?
Yeah. Jessica Jones is like, somehow I survived this.
Hulk snapped and he was like, no Iron Fist.
There's a meme out there where it's like, where Doctor Strange is talking to his buddy. He's like, is that it? And he's like, you wanted more? And like, there's like pictures of Daredevil,
the
Iron
Defenders.
Fist.
The Defenders.
With like tears. Like, oh.
We're always getting left out.
How cool would have been though to see them kind of like just pop up?
That would
like just the portal and that's all you see?
Honestly, if only Luke Cage came out, I'd be fucking stoked.
Yeah.
Actually, that would have been a really nice way to introduce somebody brand new.
Yeah.
That would have been way cool.
What if they came out and they all got fucking killed? Just like they came out, they're like, yeah, and Ebony Maw just like shoved a stick through them.
No, fucking Ant-Man, this giant man, just steps on him.
And he's like, oops.
What was that? I don't know.
And then Punisher's the only one alive, and he's like, my show's the best, obviously.
And then Kevin Feige's just like, just in the corner.
And the Disney executives are like, God damn it, we were secretly going to put those on Disney Plus. Yeah.
Okay, so the snap happens for them, right?
Yes.
And then we are whisked off into space with the opening title card of Marvel Studios and now Tony Stark and Nebula. And they
just chilling out.
They got the Guardian of the Galaxy's spaceship, the Marauder, working.
Milano.
It's the Milano.
No, it's the.
I don't know.
Is the Benatar the first one?
This is the Milano.
Okay.
This is the getaway ship that you're going to get into in Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout.
Yeah.
Yes, they're in the Milano. They are stranded as fuck in space.
Dead in the water.
And I'm going to be completely honest with you. Like, I like space, but it does freak me out. And when I saw this the first time, it gave me, like, a minor bit of anxiety.
Dude,
I was like, damn, there's nowhere to go, left or right.
It's like drowning without drowning.
Yeah, you're just like, damn, we're going to die out here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like being buried in a box, but it's like, there's no box.
The opposite.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's literally the opposite. It's just scary. So yeah, him and Nebula are connecting. They're playing flick football.
Yeah.
Which is a really cute scene when she wins. That scene, we were talking about scenes that like almost make us cry. That doesn't almost make me cry, but it does make me like tear up because I'm like, oh God damn it. She never got to win anything.
And she won. It's like first time against like a human. And she's like, you're cool.
Yeah. And he's like, puts his hand out and she shakes it. And I was like, damn, man, she could fucking kill you. But she's like, I'm so happy I won.
So going back to something that you mentioned where you think that this would have been a stronger opening, I can't agree more, because I think it would have tied the ends.
Yes.
The beginning to the end, mm-hmm. of being like, here's this guy, right? We already know his arc from before this, right? He really still is, if we want to go back to 2008, the start of it all.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? But
this is his, and tying it back to the back of it, like you're saying, mm-hmm. this is his, like, death, rebirth, spoiler alert, death. You know what I mean? Like, he's gonna die in the yeah. beginning of this, and then he's reborn, you know, in the middle of the movie, and then he dies again. But it's just like, you know, it would have been a much powerful scene. I know the opening scene with Hawkeye is powerful. It's really great, but it really is just there so you'll be like, so those people are like, yeah, where the fuck is that arrow guy?
Oh, this is what he's doing. Oh.
Yeah. It's almost a scene that didn't need to exist.
Yeah.
That could have been explained in dialogue.
Yeah, which is.
With Natasha.
It is later on in Japan. He literally, like, is exposition vomits that already. And you're like, okay, yeah, we know. I know Natasha doesn't know that, but we know that. So you don't need to spew that. But, it does lead into him finally becoming cool, but, like, god damn, it took so many movies for Hawkeye to be useful. But yeah, so Tony makes his I kept referring it to as his hologram suicide note. Just like, yeah, basically I'm gonna die. Like, yeah. we got oxygen till tomorrow.
The message in a bottle kind of thing.
Yeah, which is funny because it's like, damn, Tony, you're fucked up, but I'm pretty sure Nebula's good. Like, is she just stuck on this ship now forever in space until someone finds her? She's not struggling. She's a robot.
Yeah.
Well, not fully.
But enough.
What just occurred to me is that in Guardians 2, doesn't she, like, jack into the ship so they can warp speed or something?
Yes, but they've ran out of fuel rods.
Couldn't she power the ship, though?
Oh, dude, she's just like a charging... She's just like one of those, like, fuel rods. Yeah. She's just like...
It might not be that kind of ship, because she powered into that space mining drill.
The Ravager's ship or something?
She does have, like, jack fingers, which is really weird.
Yeah.
She's...
Scottish jack fingers.
What I'm getting at with her being fine is they show... I know he just got his fucking ass kicked, and that's why he's, like, really in rough shape, but, like...
Oh, yeah, because he's healing from a wound,
he had an infection.
Yeah.
But when they're eating the beef jerky, he offers some to her, and she's like, no, you need it more, and he eats it, and then he's like, yeah, we're really running out of oxygen. I should probably go to sleep, which is, like, basically, like, they're already running out of oxygen, and he's getting tired from, like, having to, like, breathe, and she's just like... Time to walk around the ship. She's totally fine.
Yeah.
And that is a fate worse than death, to be stuck on that ship forever.
Yeah, yeah. So he does the message, and then he falls asleep, and she picks him up and puts him in a chair.
In the captain's seat.
Yeah, and that's a nice moment.
He, like, pseudo-dies.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying he has a Jesus story.
Okay, so...
Like,
I mean, it looked like he was about to die.
He literally dies... He's reborn again in the middle of the film, and then he dies for everyone's sins.
Robert Downey Jr. is
Jesus.
Robert Downey Jr. is his real life arc.
Iron Jesus.
Basically.
Yeah.
He just had to smoke crack, and he'd be good to go.
Well, that's a weird thing that they never did with Tony's arc, is touch on the alcoholism of Tony's arc.
They switched that with PTSD,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They do a little bit in the first movie.
The second one.
He pounds
pisses in his suit.
Yeah.
Yeah. People ask me all the time, how'd I go to the bathroom in this thing? I just did.
Yeah, they touch on it a little bit. That it is insane that there literally could not have been a role better written for Robert Downey Jr.
Guys, amazing.
Yeah, that was a casting choice beyond casting choice.
Jon Favreau.
I know, man.
Yeah, did a great job.
But the thing is, like, what's insane about that casting choice is it's also, like, this is Iron Man was Disney's first Marvel film.
Well, this is Paramount.
Yep.
At this time. Are they Paramount?
They hadn't owned... That's right. They did not own Marvel Studios to 2009.
Shit, that's right.
Right? And their first official one was Avengers.
Yeah,
it's,
look.
It's not Iron Man 2?
Huh? No. No. Nope. No, sir.
Wow.
Nope.
Well,
because
still, okay.
all the first five are Paramount and Universal.
Yes.
Oh, shit.
With a Marvel Studios logo attached to that, because basically Marvel Studios was, like, established, but had not, like, basically sold the rights to Disney yet.
Well, okay, so... Wait, so
I think Iron Man 3 was the first one released under Disney.
Was it? Because I thought Disney purchased Marvel Studios at the point of Iron Man 1. They owned the character rights, but other places still had the character leases.
Possibly. I thought it was 2009.
No, because from what I understand is that everyone, basically the stuff that Disney got was the characters that everyone was like, yeah, no one gives a shit about these characters.
Well, yeah.
Because everyone else had X-Men, yeah, Spider-Man. So what I was Fantastic getting at War. Was that with Iron Man... Like, first off, I know Robert Downey Jr. was in no place to really be passing up roles because he had really fallen on hard times. But, like, holy shit. Like, who would have thought taking a chance on a superhero that no one gave a shit about would erupt into this, like, renaissance of your career?
Oh, yeah. Multi-billion dollar role. That
yeah.
Made him over the course of the universe.
Like, talk about the foresight of just being like, yup. I'll do it.
I'm in.
Yeah. It's just insane. And yeah, like I said, Disney, I don't want to like, I don't want to suck Disney's dick too hard on this, but like, Jesus Christ, did they have the foresight to make characters that no one had ever even heard of too?
Purchased. So Disney purchased it in 2009.
Okay. So this wasn't a Disney one yet.
And Marvel for $4 billion. They made that up.
Okay, yeah, so Iron Man 3 was actually still Paramount Pictures as well.
Interesting. Okay. Yep. And the Avengers was too.
Yeah.
It said Avengers and Iron Man from Paramount Pictures.
Yeah, so that was
and
my
then
mistake.
Distribution rights for Avengers and
Okay. Disney purchased the distribution rights to Iron Man, Iron Man 2, Thor and Captain America from so they were released by Disney.
Yeah.
They were just produced by Paramount.
Right.
So yeah, they owned the characters.
Right.
They just had to lease them basically for the time being. But yeah, what I'm saying is, I mean, like, let's list off the characters that Disney owns and tell me how many people knew about them before Disney put out a character.
The Guardians of the Galaxy?
They were literally a B-run comic that yeah. no one knew about.
Oh, yeah.
Iron Man was just like, oh, everyone knows the song.
No. Iron Man had a cartoon in the 90s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think
everybody as an image knew Captain America.
Everyone knew Captain America, but like...
And everybody knows Hulk.
Well, everyone knew Hulk. That was the biggest one they really got, was Hulk.
I would say the core four, like, out of all four of them, actually Iron Man is the least known.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Iron Man is like, who the fuck would care? And then they attach this guy who literally is the embodiment somehow.
With, like, the coolest redesign of a suit you could possibly get.
Yeah, he went from, like, Tin Can Man to fucking, like, super cool.
God, I love the suit. So he's my Hot favorite Rod, character in the entire franchise.
I'm going to have to throw that to my boy, Captain America.
Well, I know.
I love Captain
America.
We're
going to have a civil war on that right here.
Kick your ass.
What do you got,
baby? I'll be the Spider-Man in the middle.
Yeah, I know.
I default Spider-Man.
I mean, that's just growing up.
That's fine.
No, but that's funny. It's like, you know, Spider-Man was and always has really been like the Marvel superhero.
That's why Sony bought him back in the day.
Because they were like, damn, we're going to get it. And then they were like, we'll get it right eventually.
And then they did.
With Disney's help. Yeah. They're like, all right, Disney, please, we see you know how to make a movie. Just help us.
Right? Oh, we won an Academy Award. Oh, sorry, we're taking it back.
Yeah, basically.
That's what's going to happen. I'm so scared.
No, it already...
Like, in a way.
It already kind of is with, like, their planned sequel for Venom that they want Tom Holland Spider-Man to show up in. They're basically trying to be like, oh, yeah, thanks for teaching us everything you know, idiots.
Well, with the whole multiverse thing.
I know. Now it can do whatever.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that at the end, too. Yeah. That Spider-Man trailer.
We'll touch on
it. Let's just get back to the movie, though. Captain Marvel, again, just like she'll do later on in this movie, just Deus Ex Machina's herself into the plot and just shows up at the right time.
Yep.
So
this is weird for me, okay? So let's... she shows up, And then it moves over to Captain America has shaved his beard off. And
yeah, what the fuck?
And now feels an earthquake and goes outside, and it's Captain Marvel bringing the Milano down.
Milano, that's a slur.
Damn it, stop! bringing it down
to
Earth.
A cookie?
Milano is a
cookie.
Okay. Milano is a bad word.
Damn it. And so my problem with this is that the end credits teaser for Captain Marvel is different than her arrival here on Earth. So please explain this to me and what you think is happening here.
So after watching it on the second time,
uh-huh,
her arrival scene
isn't marked with any significance. You're right.
It's not, but also her arrival scene, the outfit she's wearing when she arrives is the same outfit after she drops off Tony. So I think when she came, she was like, yo, also, where the hell is, like, I've been waiting.
Oh, like maybe, like, Tony Stark was in the back, in the bed.
Like, she got him, got the signal, and was like, oh. I don't know. It doesn't make sense.
So let's go into that end credit scene. So basically the setup, what we're talking about here, is the Captain Marvel end credit scene, or mid-end credit scene, shows that... the remaining people of Avengers that were not snapped are now all hovering around and trying to figure out what this 90s pager is.
Yeah, why it keeps blinking. And then it just stops.
Right.
And they're like, oh, great.
Right. The pager that Nick Fury activated at the end credits teaser of Infinity War.
Yes.
Right? So now they're all here trying to figure out what that is. It fails. It stops working. And then immediately there is Captain Marvel. And she just goes, where's Nick Fury?
And she goes, where's Fury?
Right? And now that, I'm like, did that actually happen? Or did that get rewritten? Like,
well, see, so no one... Here, go ahead.
My envisioning of this whole current events is... She comes down. Where's Fury? They're like, oh, here, let me fill you in. We're also missing Iron Man, who's floating in space.
That's literally what I was just going to say.
That's
what I was going to say.
Him,
yes. What I was just going to say is that she comes there. They're like, yeah, we don't know. Also, we don't, like, who are you? And we don't know Iron Man. Or we don't know where Iron Man is. And she,
I forgot him.
I don't even know who you are. And she's like, okay, I'll go find him and I'll bring him back. And that's that.
Yeah.
I could see that.
That's
what
I think,
yeah,
too.
But it's just, it's odd.
It is very weird. But you know what? Why it's so odd? It was filmed before she filmed Captain Marvel,
yes,
and before she filmed Endgame. That's why it feels so out of place. She finished Endgame before she ever finished Captain Marvel. Before she ever shot a single thing for Captain Marvel, Endgame was finished.
Yep.
Which is like, wow. That is weird. Talk about, like, having to develop your character backwards, like, already established. Well, which could be why she's so fucking cocky in her, like, interviews, because the character, to her, was already deeply established. It's like, I've been working on this for years. And it's like, oh, because my movies are releasing weird.
Yeah.
I guess so. Yeah. It was just one of those things where, to us, as an audience member, it seems like she randomly bumped into them in space.
Yeah,
right?
No.
On her way to Earth.
No, she knew. I think she knew.
She knew. There's no way she would find him in space.
Yeah, because like, they're literally, what did he say? They're like light years away from the nearest 7-Eleven. But it's like, they're way out there in space.
Which also brings up the fact of, like, your superpowers aren't like GPS tracking somebody. How'd you find him in space?
Maybe she knew where Titan was and sort of like backtracked.
She's like weary of all... like shit. Yeah. She says that later. But yeah, they bring Tony back. Pepper is not snapped.
Nope.
I wish she was. Stop writing those goop articles.
She's reading up on compost, guys?
No, I have a good one for that later. Don't worry. She didn't get snapped, and Tony is so excited.
They did really good. I'm going to assume that they did the opposite of what they did to Chris Evans in the first Captain America, because he looks malnourished.
Yeah.
I was like,
he doesn't look like a bobblehead.
No, no, but it's good. Where yeah. I was like, damn, did he do that to his body?
I think he might have.
Or did they like malnourish him via effects? Either way, it looks good, and you're like, damn. Like for me, like I said, he's my hero, so I'm like, this guy's just done.
Yeah.
And it was sad.
They get inside and they
get inside.
they inside the Avengers headquarters.
Yeah.
And they talk about like what has happened.
And
God damn, does Iron Man hold a grudge?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, man.
Like, how many years?
That's three movies ago.
Yeah.
He's like, you were supposed to be there for me and you weren't, asshole. And he's like, I'm trying to save everyone else too.
Also, fuck your friend. Yeah. Still.
Yeah. I don't care about that communist arm.
Right?
He's like, damn, man.
Commie arm.
And then I always joke about my favorite scene when he's just like, you know what? I'll kill myself. Just takes his shit off. It's like, dead.
Well, that's not what happens.
No.
They also talk about Ultron and how he was right the whole time.
Yeah, which is... It's like, talk about some revisionist history, because, like... I think you fucked up a little bit, Tony. Yeah. I think you could take a little of the blame here and be like, yeah, Ultron was not good.
Yeah.
That was version one.
You killed thousands of people when a city came crashing back down to Earth.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. But
That's one of the weird things. I know he's stubborn. I know that's his, like, character thing. But, like, that's a bit weird. Because in Civil War, he's straight up super haunted by that woman being like, my son died in Sokovia. Mm-hmm. And that changes his whole shit. And he's like, damn. And then in this one, just to be like, you know what? Actually, I'm glad we killed all those people in Sokovia, because it could have worked.
Well, that's an interesting thing. It's not really backtracking on the character as much as literally just like any human being. Like, as things happen to you, your arc might change. Your opinions on things might change constantly.
Yeah.
So, like,
but also,
I'll
like,
give it.
As we see later, like, do we really think some robots around Earth are going to stop that?
No, not
that ship straight up just flew out of the ceiling. I think we're good. Like, I don't think anything's gonna happen there.
I mean, if we were talking about creating a whole bunch of visions, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. That'd be dope.
Yeah.
And then they could wear the gauntlet and, you know, snap everyone back together.
Oh damn. Shit, like a time vision, a soul vision.
Yeah.
Just whoa. Six visions.
That'd be insane. Right. That'd be pretty cool.
But they're all Raw Dog and Wanda.
Stay tuned. Stay tuned for WandaVision on Disney Plus. The worst fucking title.
WandaVision times six.
Which is also weird, because I guess that's like gonna be Watchmen. I guess that's gonna be a pre-Endgame series.
Is it?
Because it's about her and Vision.
I would say rebuild him.
Yeah, I don't think it's pre.
You think they're gonna make him again?
Yeah,
why would
they have to?
That's lame as fuck.
Why would you like, the one guy that got snapped.
Shuri was almost to completion of creating him without a stone.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah,
oh, shit,
episode
about
one
that.
Opens with her finishing the new Vision.
Sure.
2.0.
And then Vision gets chopped in half by Darth Maul. The words episode one will forever be burned in my mind that it's we're talking about Phantom Menace.
And then Vision becomes like a spider.
Yeah.
And then three episodes later, like, yeah, the spider legs were dumb. Give him robot legs. No, yeah, so they're all talking, and they're basically, yeah, like we're saying, Tony's like, said some shit like this was gonna happen. And, you know, I know he very briefly says, you know, I had a vision about this. Which is like, yeah, you did, and that was some scary shit, and I don't know why that's not brought up again.
But also, when we talk about, like, anytime they mention the vision, which he had, that basically Scarlet Witch gave him in the beginning of Age of Ultron, to me, that vision doesn't really fit in with, like, the... Like, I'm like, which vision are we talking about that you saw? Did you see the events of the end of Age of Ultron? Did you see...
No, like, he saw the events of the end of the world.
I guess
yeah,
so?
At the hands of Thanos.
At the hands of Thanos. He literally saw what we saw at the end. But what the problem is you're bringing up exactly my point. Go all or nothing on that.
Yeah.
It's gotta be... The vision is fully going to be fledged out and it's going to keep coming up. Or don't mention it at all, because I promise you, everyone has kind of forgotten about Age of Ultron, just like they want you to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah. So, basically, that rivalry from Civil War is still intact.
But it's one sided.
It's because Captain America is a good dude.
He's the bigger man.
Yeah,
literally. Yeah. Also, to touch on that, holy shit, did Chris Evans get bigger for this movie?
Because
he looks huge. There's a scene where he's wearing like one of those. I think it's this scene. He's wearing like a two button top shirt.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, I'm like, God. Damn, carry me in your arms.
Yeah, yeah. When he's sitting at the coping meeting, like the AA, but
with his arms crossed.
Yeah, he's like, we all just gotta move on. And like the guy, the Russo brother next to him is like, I don't think I can.
He's like, fuck, dude. Those things are huge.
So, so Tony basically like just monologues. Everybody's like, dude, shut the fuck up. Like, stop. And he finally is just like, you know what? Take my suit of armor, rips it off his chest, and is like, you take it and you put it on and then you still fucking run.
Yeah.
Right? Which is, it's a very interesting thing because his monologue and everything that he's talking about is in this moment very selfish. Right? Which is a great arc for this movie, too, because it's very selfish in this way of basically describing the events that happened to him like nobody else has seen Thanos, and he's warning them. And it's like, fool, everybody dealt with him.
Also, fool, all the other people in this room actually straight up were there when he snapped. They are almost more single-handedly responsible because they couldn't stop him in the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yo, new girl, we're all about that superhero life.
Yeah.
That's a weird line.
That's a weird Don Cheadle is like, he doesn't like Brie Larson either for real, so I think that just like channeled into him. Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. It's like, it is a cool, it is a cool, like, arc for Tony to literally go back to Iron Man 1 Tony of just, like, you guys didn't listen? Fuck you.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be a part of your little team because every time I say we should do something, you guys say no. And it's like, yeah, but every time you say something, you have been wrong. So, like...
Yeah.
Like,
or you haven't, you've thought about the science, you've thought about like this, but you haven't thought about the moral consequences.
Yeah, there's no execution. And so, yeah, he basically is like, fuck you guys, I just would rather die.
Yeah.
So
basically, he's passed out. Captain Marvel's like, I'm going to go kill Thanos. And then, like, everybody else is like, hey, I'm sure you could do it on your own, but we've all got a grudge to bear.
Yeah.
Right. And so, so Nebula is like, I can tell you exactly where he is. Right.
Which is wild because they all, it's almost like some shit out of a comedy. It straight up almost needs like the, like record scratch because they're all like, it's like, what the fuck are we doing here then?
Oh yeah, Blue Girl.
Wait, you mean you know where he is the whole time?
Right.
And then again, Don Cheadle.
Well, that was a cool moment with her and Rocket holding hands.
Yeah, that was sweet. That was
very touching.
But when she was like, she's like, yeah, I know where he is. He's at the.
But then she doesn't.
He's like, she's like, he's at the garden. And so he's got a retirement plan? It's like, all right, Don. You're trying your best, I know, but shit, dude.
Don, you'll have one cool line, and it's about Indiana Jones. Everything else, stop trying to be Iron Man.
It's a. Tyrese in Fast and Furious.
Woo! Luna! This, with what he's saying, brings up a gripe that I'm gonna bring up over and over again, so might as well address it now. And I've gotten over it being a gripe necessarily, and more realizing that it is necessary, but it did still really bother me on my first watch. And that's that.
The girl scene.
No, I actually.
I'm just gonna keep doing it.
I'm gonna. When we get to it, you're gonna be surprised at what I'm gonna say.
Okay.
No, this movie has a very tough time with just leaving you with something sad.
Oh yeah.
All the way until, and I understand that the ending and the middle, there are some big punches that happen that don't have that moment of levity at the end of them. But for the most part, this is a pretty sad movie. And, like, every time you're about to get sad, they're like, quick, someone quit! Someone quit! And then someone's like, he has a retirement plan? And it's like, ha ha ha, I just forgot about the sad thing that happened. Because it's like, they really don't want to leave you with like a sad moment.
Yeah.
Every single time.
I feel like that's the Disney formula for these movies. Like,
yeah.
Every tier, there should be a laughter.
Within 5 minutes, if we haven't hit at least two punches of joke,
yeah,
then you've got to throw something.
Yeah. And it's like, and that
stemmed from Guardians.
Yeah, talk about this.
But because Guardians was like the next one to be like, boom, we just opened up a can of worms of like greatness.
Yeah.
And like, and people, basically Guardians, like you have said so many times at this point, was the game changer and the reinvention of the franchise within an already fully established franchise.
Yeah, it was like, hey, we can still do the formula, but cool.
Yeah.
It's like, every time someone walks in the theater and sits down for a Marvel movie, they shouldn't be like, all right, I know what's going to happen.
Don't worry. This is the thing that DC's going to want to copy.
Yeah. You mean making money?
But, no, I was talking about Suicide Squad.
God.
Like, this is the only thing DC will copy.
I swear to God.
Even though they should copy it all.
The snap did rip a tear in the space-time continuum, because we are living in a world where we're getting not only a James Gunn Suicide Squad, but also a James Gunn Guardians of the Galaxy 3.
Maybe
so,
as Guardians.
I really hope so.
Me too.
and Roseanne's like, where's my show?
She's like, ah, I hate them. I hate the minorities. Fuck Roseanne. This movie does actually, and now I'm thinking about it more and more, it's not just sad moments, it's almost every moment is like, quick, put a laugh in there, please.
Don't have a problem with it, because I get what you're saying.
I understand why they're doing it, because they are trying to, like, not make it just, like fucking Schindler's List of superhero movies. Like, you don't want to just be sitting here being like, fuck, man, this is sad.
Well, and you cry for like
This quip right here would have saved one more life.
And you cry for like a solid 20 minutes after, you know, when Iron Man does his snap. You're like,
yeah.
You're crying all throughout that scene. And then the funeral scene.
Yeah, if you're lame as fuck.
Hey.
I even teared up during Captain America and Peggy dancing or whatever.
Well, the first time I watched it, yes, I've never.
Oh, that's where I teared
I've never
up too.
Recried on that one.
That's the only one
I haven't recried.
I was like, he's so happy.
So basically, they're like, yeah, we found this signature. There was another snap on this planet, and she's like, that's where he is. So they go to it, and they just fuck his shit up. Thanos is just a peaceful farmer now. It's like the scene from Rogue One. He's like, a man of your talents. Farming. Yes. Knock, knock, knock. Who is it? It's us, Thanos!
Back from the dead.
Nice place, bitch.
I was just making some eggs.
Nice place, back up.
You gotta do it.
Yeah, kicks his shit in. He's like, ah! Or no, it's Captain Marvel.
Who's making stew? You want some?
It's Captain Marvel who just blows his roof in.
He was picking like the
weird prickly fruits
from Super Mario World.
Yeah. He's just like, all right, time to make this gross paste food.
Yeah. So, yeah, she just blasts through the door with a blast first and then her full body.
Yeah, and he's like, it is funny, though, because, like, even though, as we learn, he's, like, straight up in, like, a weakened state, he's still just like, the fuck is that noise? Put my arm up. Yeah. And then,
he's two-faced right now.
Yes. Yeah. And they rock his shit.
Yeah, so she's just straight up like gets him in like a chokehold, and then Bruce Banner in the Hulkbuster suit just pops out of the ground.
Yeah, exactly.
Zombie!
I'm a mole!
Right? And then from another side, here comes War Machine holding his other hand, right? And they're just all there, and then here comes Thor, is like, fuck your hand!
He just chops
his hand with the gauntlet.
Boom, hand drops.
Yeah, that scene, that was more surprising than what's about to happen to me when they cut his hand off. I was like, whoa! Why was it this easy?
that's what we're supposed to do the last time?
I do have a little theory about this. Mm-hmm. But then they're all struggling. He tells them, I destroyed the stones. Go fuck yourselves. I used the power of the stones to stop the stones. They were no longer of use to me.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, damn. That this is a scene where I was like, shit, Thanos, he did a bad thing, but he's like not the worst, because he really wasn't trying to rule the galaxy. He was just
not
like,
at all.
I'm just trying to fix it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's like, but it is pretty shitty.
You know what's funny about it, though? Okay, I thought about this, too, where it's like, okay, Thanos, you tried to fix the universe, right? What happens millions of years from now when we're right back to where we were?
He'll do it again.
But he can't.
The stones are destroyed.
Oh, shit.
Right? This fool should be holed up somewhere and, like, literally, like, having babies and being like, this is what you do one day. Pass it to your next generation.
That is true. Yeah. But could this also be...
Or literally snap every couple years.
All the film school I went to has taught me that every movie is a Christ allegory. So, like, he, you know, decided who lived and who died. He basically raptured them and then went to, like, the Garden of Eden. It was just like, fuck it, I'm God.
His suit was on a cross.
I know, it is on a cross. It's funny you say it's on a cross, because I couldn't stop thinking of it just T-posing, like, videoing, like, just stuck like that.
It's just a scarecrow for, like, the non-crows in there.
Yeah. No, there's crows in space, if I've learned anything from Ewoks.
Yeah, space crows, that's right.
Yeah, they rock his shit. He tells them, I destroyed the stone. Sorry, you're too late. And they're like...
And Nebula confirms that yeah, like, she's he's like, a liar. My father's not a liar. And they're like, well, cut his head off.
Yeah, Thor just straight up just like... Wah!
Mid-sentence. Yeah, he's like, really goes, epic moment.
I am inevitable.
Right?
It's like... And they show a blood splatter.
They yeah. do, all on her face. It goes on Nebula's face.
Yes.
And it's like, dang.
And even Rocket's like, God... Damn.
Yeah, he goes, what'd you do?
He's like, I went for the head.
That's epic. Right?
That is fucking sweet.
And then it just, he walks out into a complete, like, rack focus. Like, it's just completely blurry.
Yeah.
And and I was like, Dan, a movie's over.
Yeah.
Roll credits.
He was like, thank you for coming. Thanks for your money.
Could you imagine? That's the end. End no. game. That's what we said.
Yeah. No, so.
I do like the opening, like, the final title card where he's like, let's go get this son of a bitch.
Yes.
I was like, yes. Yeah. Okay, so that's something that I do want to touch on is, like, certain things, how you felt when certain moments, right? And that, I think, is a huge one, right? Like, we're...
I'm thinking of a moment right now that comes later that I just thought about it, and it gave me, like, a little bit of chills. So
I'll say one later. Too.
Yeah.
So this one here was just, like, basically, because it didn't open... Like, in that normal Marvel movie strong way.
Where it's just like, pow, 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 pow. Yeah.
Either pow, pow, or something so ominous. Because, like, for me, the Hawkeye thing didn't hit where it should have. Right?
It's still sad, and yeah. it still sets. But like I said, it's just for you to be like, right? Oh, yeah, arrow guy.
Oh, yeah.
But this whole, let's go get this son of a bitch, right? Yeah. You're just like, you are the real deal now, Captain America.
Because he doesn't swear, because he used to always be like, language.
Dude, he swears language. So much in this film.
Yeah, he doesn't give a shit anymore, dude.
It's great.
And he also, again, like, you know, like I said, because I will rant and rave and rave and rave about the two other Captain America movies, Civil War and Winter Soldier, where he finally kind of comes into his own as a character. Thematically, it is a little like ham-fisted that his costume literally becomes darker in those movies, yeah. which is wild. But like his fighting style drastically changes too.
Mm-hmm.
He becomes straight up ruthless.
Dirty.
Yeah. Like in Civil War when mm-hmm. he's beaten Iron Man's ass. It's just like he's just like pounding him with the shield.
I feel like it was pretty equal.
Well, when he fights himself in the time heist,
he's fucking insane. Yeah, yeah.
That's a good moment.
Yeah.
Okay.
This whole interaction with Thanos right off the bat is just like, damn, you guys straight up fucking lost. Like, there's no coming back from this. You guys, he got you good.
He thought it out.
Yeah.
And that's why I rather have Infinity Thanos, not Endgame Thanos.
I will get to why I like Endgame Thanos so much.
Okay.
In a second.
Okay.
All right.
So, now we hit the title card 5 years later.
Yes.
5 years have passed, right? We are introduced to a world in which people decided to make boat docks around the Statue of Liberty. I don't know what that was.
That was a little weird.
That was weird because I was the
port of Statue of Liberty.
the establishing shot of where we are is so foggy. I was like, what fucking city is this? And then it was like, Statue of Liberty. Oh, New York. Cool. Yeah, there's boats everywhere.
There used to be other monuments, but we can't show them.
Yeah. They got snapped too.
Dust.
Any monument that looked like a person was gone.
It's okay. We can do this joke now. It's been 10 years.
Yeah. Which joke?
Oh, are we not on the same page here?
Were you making a 9/11 joke?
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say those got snapped.
That's what I thought you did.
No, I was just, they don't look like people.
No.
We need to snap those Confederate monuments.
Oh, yeah.
That's right, comrades. So they're in the middle of survivor's guilt. like.
Oh, man, I want to see Thanos with a red hat on.
Make the universe equal again.
Nah, dude.
It's the purple hat.
Damn. We're in like a, it's all, it really is like, it's basically like, what do we do now that they're gone?
Which is a great thing that I really, like, just jumping forward for a second, I really hope we get to explore even more in the next movie.
I hope they will.
I think they will.
It's like a survivor's guilt thing for people who are like, shit, man, like, I lost everything. And then there's this really weird, because people have been asking for it, and honestly, it needs to be represented, but they were really underhanded on like, yeah, this guy's gay. Yeah. All right, anyway.
Moving on.
Also, Captain America is very progressive for a man from 1945.
Yeah, I expected him, when he was like, oh, so how'd your date go? And he's like, yeah, so like, he cried during the dinner, and I was expecting him to be like, oh, what, he?
Anyway, next guy.
Does anybody got a heterosexual date story?
Yeah, and that's one of the Russo brothers, that guy. Yeah.
Yeah, because Captain America, God, why is there two captains in this goddamn universe? Captain America, he's like, yeah, when I went into the ice in 45, I lost the love of my life, and she's really important.
Yeah. No, yeah, and it's just like, and he's like, you know, we gotta do what we gotta do. We gotta just keep going on. And I was like, yo, is anyone else in this room freaking out that fucking Captain America is sitting with them? Because I would be like, first off, I'd be like, yo, you're Captain America. But then I'd also be like, hey, wait a minute.
Like, literally,
you're the fucking reason this happened.
Literally the only person who acknowledges in any way, shape, or form a fanboy type of status is Scott.
Yeah. He is our connection to the universe.
Yeah.
Because
he is really an everyday man.
Yeah, but that shit's so funny. They're just like, yeah, it's cool. Captain America's at my sad person thing. He gets sad.
He's
too.
At my church today.
Yeah, and I was like, okay.
Also, is he just in the meeting or is he running the meeting?
Running the meeting.
He's running the meeting.
Damn. That's So what's there's flyers just across the like the city just being like Captain America deals with your grief.
I do really like when he's talking about Peggy because I just love when he talks about her. But it is kind of like you think you've got it bad? 45 years ago, my fucking love of my life got away from me because I got frozen. And then I had to carry her casket.
And then my friend who I thought was dead became unfrozen too and tried to kill me.
And then my other friend is insane. Also, I couldn't prevent the snap. The dude's like, fuck, all right, I just want to tell you about my gay date. You think you have a bed? You ever lose your shield? Those things are priceless, asshole.
I had to deal with Nazis.
I fought a Nazi with a skeleton face. He was also the guy from The Matrix. It was fucked up.
I fought Robert California.
They tried to tell me it was the past, but it was the present, and they lied on the radio about the outcome of a game.
I was there!
Other person's like, starts like sneaking out. I was like, where the fuck do you think you're going? I was just getting a bagel.
No! Bullshit! I haven't even told you about those weird PSAs I had to make for high schoolers. They're the best thing he's ever done in that
Do you know
franchise.
How weird it is to tell kids not to fuck when you haven't done it yourself? God, Captain America's got it so rough. I love him. Anyway, back to your gay date story.
Yeah, there was one time they said, get me a shield, and they got me these two weird claw things.
That's right. That was an infinite. Dude, that shit's cool, though. And then I shaved my beard off.
And now I live with a goddamn raccoon.
Wow, shit's really crazy.
Where does Rocket live in this new world?
In the trash can.
Like, apartment?
Trash panda.
The posters for this, they're actually, please come listen to my problems. And he's like crying.
Welcome to the Captain America podcast. It's called After the Snap.
Yeah, so then we go to...
okay, so at this point...
Back to the offices.
No, now we go to a You Store It.
That's right.
So
Ken Jeong's there for some reason.
Yeah, and doesn't have a single line.
No,
it's
but he's
weird.
Just so happy to be there and not naked.
I feel like he had like an interaction with him that got cut.
I think so.
Probably. Right? Yeah.
There's no way that you would get Ken Jeong in there and not do a bit.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, because what's her name?
It's like Transformers.
Yvette Nicole Brown.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which is a weird one because that's another connection to Community.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's there. And so this is a weird thing for me, too, where I'm like, so everybody that got snapped got lucky enough to have their stuff put into storage?
Well, yeah, I guess.
There was probably a
I
lot
think
of
his
trash.
Shit got impounded.
Yeah.
I think that's what
especially
happened.
The
that's
car.
Not – it wouldn't be in a – like a you-pay-for-it storage thing. The only thing I can think of is that Cassie did it.
Oh, yeah. That would make sense. Like,
right?
Oh, this is
but
my
she
dad's
was a
shit.
Child.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or,
right?
Or, yeah.
What would have been nice is to, like, at least explain, like, the mom survived or the stepdad.
Yeah.
Right? And put that in the storage.
Yeah.
Right? That one's left somewhere on the cutting room floor, I feel like.
Yeah.
Right?
Could be.
But he,
because I'm like, there's no way, there's shit lying all over San Francisco. There's no way that people were just like, anybody who become the Vanished is now, like, put the stuff in the storage. Because we're assuming that they're dead. Why would you store dead people's storage?
A Tarantino reference in there for a second.
Does it say dead people storage on my shit? No, it doesn't say it on my garage.
Does it say Ant-Man stuck in the quantum realm storage? Yeah, he just gets lucky that a rat crawls across the thing and yeets him out, which is really weird, but that's okay. Yeah,
some things are very coincidental.
Yeah,
and we gotta forgive
of
them.
Could you imagine if he never got out and then they never could fix anything? If that rat wouldn't have crawled across that, nothing ever would have happened.
Imagine that he finally got out like 100 years later.
He's right? Like, God, I've been in there for 25 minutes. Yeah. What year is it? And he's like, God, damn you all to hell. They blew it up!
It's just a whole bunch of docks around the Statue of Liberty. It's just all the way up to her face.
He's like, oh no, which one is it? Which one is it? Was it Abraham Lincoln? God damn it! I'm in this one!
Thank God I'm white!
So yeah, he gets out. Ken Jeong gives him his shit, and he just leaves. And he starts walking down his street.
There's missing posters everywhere.
Which, by the way, I don't know, like, where he's supposed to live, but that looks like Marin, which is, like, super
Look
fucking far from San Francisco. I mean, it's not super far, but it would be a long walk. But yeah, and he asks some kid, he's like, hey, what happened? And the kid's like, fuck you. Just, like, leaves.
Yeah. So then he goes to, like, a memorial that's built around the Golden Gate Bridge.
Yeah.
And that's where he, basically discovers that there is a memorial and that more, like, he's figuring more stuff out. He looks for Cassie's name on the memorial. He winds up seeing his own instead. He goes to where I assume Cassie's mom and them lived.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And knocks on a door, and there she is, as 5 years aged person, like a teen or something, right?
Yeah, I think she's like 18.
Yeah.
Cause
she looked 18.
Yeah. Let's hope so.
What? That was weird.
not like that.
Just she looked at you.
She's cute. They hug. That's another tender moment that kind of almost got me.
Almost got me on that one, too.
A surprise from Paul Rudd pulling off this amazing, heart-touching moment.
He's always been amazing, guys. Like, I don't know why people are so surprised.
Everyone's used to him being goofy and everything.
Like, yeah, everyone's used to him being a dumb shit.
Yeah, but he's just... amazing, like,
but
always.
Like, think about it, he was definitely cast on type for that role, but look at who else was cast on type and didn't really break it is Chris Pratt.
Yeah.
He gets some depth in number two.
Yeah.
and a bit in, well, like actually a lot in Infinity War, but he still comes back as like, hey, it's me, dipshit. Yeah. It's like, and I know that's who he is.
Yeah, but they leaned hard on that in Endgame of like, look at this dipshit.
Yeah, they were like, yeah. Yo, he really fucked it up.
Well, I think they did that for us.
To be like, yeah, we get it. He fucked up.
Yeah.
So he has this tender moment with his daughter.
Yeah, almost cried. I don't know what it was about.
I started tearing up. I was like, this is an amazing moment right here.
Yeah.
So Jonathan farted in. He was like, oh, so sad.
Yeah. So now we go over and we're back in New York.
Yes, at the Avengers
headquarters. Right, the not the tower.
Upstate New York.
Headquarters. Yeah. Yes. So now we have Black Widow, yes, who is having hologram conferences.
That hair is so hot. Jesus Christ.
What hair?
Black Widow? Like blonde red that she has.
The red with the blonde tips.
She's just hot. Even when she looks tired and crying.
No, she looks really good. Yeah. I'll console you.
Yeah.
Remember when Ryan Reynolds divorced you? Aww. I'm here.
Pika. Oh, that's going to be weird. He comes back into the franchise now.
Remember when he divorced you and everyone was like, there's no way he could marry anyone hotter, and then he married Blake Lively? That was fucked up, Scarlett. We're on your side.
If the Deadpool meets the Avengers...
That would be wild.
He's the one that brings her back.
He's like, yeah, you idiots, you have to pick her body up and she comes back to life.
Yeah. You just gotta sleep with her dead body.
What do you think the Soul Stone's power is?
She's just soulless now.
So now Black Widow is kind of taken over for Nick Fury.
Yeah, she's running the shit.
Right, and she's having a hologram like conference of monitoring the rest of the world. So you have Nebula and Rocket are scouting some garbage barge.
Yeah, they're
somewhere.
Just like, what the fuck? You sent us to a trash heap.
Yeah.
And that was just pretty funny. I'm glad we finally got to this, because there's something I do want to like say. It's like, she's so paranoid now.
Yes.
About anything, because she's straight up having the Dora Milaje investigate an undersea earthquake.
Yeah.
And she's like, well, what is it? And she's like, it's an earthquake. Like, that's all it is.
How do we deal with it?
We don't. Yeah. But the line for me that I really like is obviously the banter between Rocket and Captain Marvel's funny when he's like, oh, well, you got to go get a new haircut.
Oh, you know what? What's weird about that scene, right? So her haircut is a subtle reference to the fact that Brie Larson would like to speak to your manager.
Oh, you're so dumb. You had me going for a second.
Like, to the comics, yeah? When she cuts her hair?
Yeah. Yeah, when you said subtle reference, I was like, here we go, shitty movie detail. No,
I'd like to speak to your manager.
What I like when he's like, oh, you gotta go get another haircut, what I really like this line is when she's just like, no, like, basically, like, you're aware that it wasn't just Earth that got snapped, right? And he's like, oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah, it's like, damn, like,
puts it in perspective.
Yeah. It's like, that is true, though. It's like, here they are crying. Well, not crying. I mean, they have the right to cry, but they're very upset about what happened on their planet. Meanwhile, Captain Marvel is, like, the protector of the universe, and is like, you guys are, like, thinking small time here. Like, there's millions of planets where they had the same shit happen to them, and they don't have the Avengers.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So... My thought is, like, when in this, the snap happens and everyone goes away, but in the past 5 years, was there no supervillain trying to just take over this wounded universe?
Yeah, that's a bit weird. I guess everyone was just like, yeah, man, we're all really fucking bummed.
It's
we can't
too soon,
deal
man.
With that.
Maybe a bunch of villains didn't make the snap. That might be.
Well, what about new ones
of
that
a threat,
were...
but might have been an actual legitimate threat.
Yeah.
And anybody who was. This is what Black Widow has been doing for the past 5 years.
Yeah, just taking him out.
So there's a movie. That's what a movie's about.
That'd be nice.
This guy's like, ha, it's finally my time to shoot. I don't feel so good. I'm the Prowler.
Get out of here.
It's me, Big Wheel.
I'm Mr. Dotman.
Kite Man. Yeah.
I'm the Waffler.
Mustard King.
They all leave.
Oh, it's Condiment King.
Yeah, Condiment King.
Condiment King. Yeah. I'm trying to think
Calendar
of all the...
Calendar Man.
Yeah. Yeah. It's me, Electro, not to be confused with the other one.
Yeah. So now at this point,
this is when Don Cheadle, like, everyone leaves. Yeah. And Don Cheadle's like, yeah, I'm in Mexico. Saw some fucked up shit. I didn't catch this the first time.
Okay.
I didn't know he was talking about Clint.
Oh, no? He says Barton.
Yeah, but I was like, who the fuck's that? Because I forgot. I don't give a shit about him. Yeah, but he's like, yeah, it looks like a lot of cartel dudes. And he's like, yeah, well, you know, that's kind of like a win-win, really, for, like, really being serious here. But, yeah, he's like, it's a bunch of cartel guys, and, you know.
He's like, I don't even want to find him.
Yeah, and she's like, I do. And he's like, yeah, well, I don't. And she's like crying. She's like, please just fucking find him.
Fool, you have a war machine suit. Like, if you found him, you win.
Pretty much.
He just hits the katana on the suit. It's like, bing.
I'm gonna say it.
Shoots some arrows.
Toot. While Hawkeye is the most useless, like, superhero because of his powers, War Machine is just so useless because he just doesn't want to do shit ever. He's like, can you please just do this? You know, honestly, I'd rather not.
I'm kind of handicapped.
I can't walk unless I'm in this suit, and you have no idea how tiring it is being in this suit.
Yeah.
I forgot that he's not able to walk until the end when he's not in the suit. Oh, he's, like, crawling. I was like, oh, fuck, that's right, he can't walk.
But it's weird that he wouldn't use the braces. He wouldn't get in the suit with the braces.
Yeah, it's kind of weird.
Just in case this scenario happens.
Because he does. He usually wears those braces.
Yeah, he does. But in that scene, for some reason, he's not wearing them.
Just so that he couldn't save the day.
Yeah, he's like, I don't want to.
Yeah. So now she's like, just go find him. Captain America shows up and he, like, tries to have a conversation with her and console her about basically being like, I told everybody at the meeting to move on, but, you know, truth is, neither one of us can. Not we can't. We're superheroes, right? And it's a touching moment. But what's really important here is that ding dong at the doorbell, here's Scott Lang, right?
And before, I just wanted to touch on how you see a lot more emotion in this movie from Scarlet or Black Widow,
from people that they've left in the dust for so long. Yeah,
yeah, and like you just see her sort of. In this movie especially, you see her, like, smile, having a good time. She has, like, that whole family feeling.
Yeah, they finally figured her out.
Yeah.
And I understand
that
she...
Just to kill her.
Yep.
Yeah.
I know it was intentional because her character basically was taught not to. Because exactly. She's, like, a ruthless assassin.
Sure.
So she
sure.
shouldn't have emotions. But, yes, they finally came into her for... 45 minutes. Just like, they finally figured it out just to be like, yeet. Yes, this is when Scott Lang shows up and he says,
remember me?
A bunch of bullshit.
Ant-Man? I know I was under the mask, but, you know, like,
remember in Germany, I got real big.
Remember me, Ant-Man? I know you know Ant-Man.
Yeah, and Captain America's like, is this an old recording? Like, you know it's not. Why would you just be watching a loop thing of Ant-Man at the door? Come on, Cap. Get with it.
Jeez, Natasha.
Also,
you're
okay,
hurting,
so,
geez.
So he took the rickety van across the country?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Across, like, abandoned, like, basically a zombie apocalypse wasteland is what it would look like with, like, cars all over. You had to drive through the Walking Dead set to get there.
And he is immediately... Like, I guess in something we don't see, like, they probably explain all the rest of the loose knots of, like, Thanos to him, right? In which then he's like, okay, check it out. Here's my theory about quantum theory. So what he says is that, like, he was stuck from the events of Ant-Man and Wasp. He was stuck in the quantum realm, right? And then he was jettisoned out 5 years later. It was 5 years later for everyone else. For him, 5 hours.
Yeah.
Right? So... He's basically theorized about being like, what if you could go back into the quantum realm, but instead of jumping out, you know, like 5 hours later, right to where you were, you know, or like 5 years later, yeah. You could jump out at any point as long as you could, like, basically tell some GPS marker or something that you could do it.
Yeah.
Right.
And they're basically like,
Oh, what?
They're like, yeah, none of us are scientists.
Yeah, none of us have seen Back to the Future.
Yeah. Cap's like, yeah, I completely missed the 80s.
Yeah, that would have been actually a really good joke where he's like, you know, Back to the Future. Because that would have been, that would have made the Back to the Future, like, thing a threefer.
Yeah.
Right? Oh,
yeah.
Which is always the best way to come around on a joke, right? Yeah. So if he started with being like, you know, Back to the Future, and he's like, dude.
He's like, you do know I was frozen in ice for 45 years.
Being like, that one wasn't on my list. Remember he made the list in Winter Soldier? Yeah. You're like, ah, God, another movie I got to put on my list. That would have been a great throwback, actually.
Yeah. All together.
And then that would have made that final Back to the Future being like, Back to the Future's all bullshit?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you see Cap just sort of scratch it off. He's like, oh, never mind.
Oh, damn.
At the end?
He's like,
I've done it. Back to the Future. Always had sex with my mom. We also had a train. It's the weakest in the franchise, but it's pretty good.
Damn, Captain America Old West.
Oh, damn.
Shit.
These are essentially just our generation's Old West movies.
Yeah.
It's just like the niche right now.
Damn, he could like be there and just stop racism.
Stop it.
Me and my friend Django Falcon here.
Falcon, have you always been alone? Falcon, eventually you'll get the shield.
Leonardo DiCaprio as Red Skull.
Oh. Whoa. No, it would be Christoph Waltz. We've done this exact same
God
bit
damn it,
with Ewoks. Saying,
damn, time heist.
I just think it's like, I've heard this before.
Yeah, you're having way deja vu.
So then this is when they're like, we're not scientists, but we know someone who is, and they'll help us.
Mm-hmm.
And they go to see...
This is so strong for me. So this is another moment,
right?
This scene, right? Mm-hmm. So basically... they show up on Tony's new front doorstep, which is a nice log cabin on a lake.
Yeah.
Right? Just trying to get away from it all, forget it all. Right? And in this time...
His fucking daughter.
What's wrong?
The cutest casting.
It's so sad.
It's so predatory to your emotions. It really is. And that's what I mean is like, as soon as she pops out of that tent, right? You're like... Because at first you're like, was it a dog?
Yeah,
right? And
I was like, what is he, weird?
She pops out of that tent wearing like a new blue like metal mask, right? And you're just like, oh, God damn it. Because in your mind, what I thought was, I was like, Tony's going to have to decide. Like, because in my mind, this is how I thought the stones worked, right? Mm-hmm. I thought that the stones' only purpose was to, like, have power on their own individually or come together to reset the universe.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
No.
I didn't know
it's
that
like
it was...
will.
I didn't know it was the will of the user. I thought it was only one thing, like, basically a very definitive thing. So in my mind, in this moment, until they started explaining it later on, I was like, oh, shit, Tony's going to have to literally decide between his daughter and saving the entire world.
Which I thought, too, which still could have happened... with the will thing, if they wouldn't have done what they do.
Sure.
Which I would say arguably would have been a much stronger end for him, because he would actually, he still does sacrifice himself, but he would sacrifice so much more. But
yeah, his happiness.
Yeah, again, he still loses her in the end. Like, let's just be honest.
Maybe if like, he, like, went into the future and impregnated Pepper before he snapped.
But it wouldn't work.
It was like...
You can't affect the past or the future.
I mean, I feel like somebody's pregnant. Like, you're affecting it.
Yeah. But, yeah, so he's with his daughter. He goes inside with her. And as he's about to go inside with her, they're just like, knock, knock, we're here interrupting your day.
Yeah.
We didn't call, sorry.
So it's Captain America, Black Widow, and Ant-Man proposing what Ant-Man proposed to them, right, about time travel. And straight up, he is throwing out terms which are, like, to me right now, I'm like, I still want to look up what this Deutsch property is.
I do too.
Yeah. Wait, but it's so called? Deutsch property. Right. It's so funny because...
Something of the Plantar system or something? I don't know.
But it's so funny because it's literally like, you fucking idiots, like, literally thought with a basic knowledge you would figure time travel out?
Yeah,
like,
I love it. This is a good moment for
it's
him.
It's like, I'm Tony Stark. You don't think I would have figured this out by now?
Tony Stark, bitch.
Yeah, and they're like, Tony, please. And this is, again, like, he is a dickhead in this movie.
Sure.
He's straight up the, like, textbook of, like, shit's going good for me.
Yeah.
They're like, fuck you guys.
Which is amazing for the rest of the arc. I mean, it's designed this way.
Yeah, I know it is.
Yeah.
It is.
As you pointed out, at the same time, you're just like, oh, and that's what makes him the best by the end.
No, he's not the best. Asshole.
He's the best.
We learn
he's
who's the
best emotional arc in this whole movie. Yes. You know it.
No. We learn who's the best at the end of this.
Uh-huh.
Melted ice cream, Thor.
Oh, it's coming. we're getting there. It's a slow crawl for us. But...
I know. Yeah, so he basically is just like, no. It's like, I would ruin everything I have now. So, no. And then the thing that I think is really powerful in this scene is it's kind of just a throwaway thing. Is he's like, table set for six. You guys can come in if you're not going to talk shop.
Yeah.
And they all leave. And it's like,
stood him up.
Shit, man. They're
like, we got nothing else to talk about.
Yeah, that's what's so powerful. But it's like, you know, he is incredibly selfish, but as are they. They're not trying to fix anything with Tony. They're just concerned about what they want to do.
Right.
And it's like, that's pretty rough. That's like, he's like, you can come in my house. I haven't seen you in 5 years. You can meet my kid, see Pepper. We can have lunch. You just can't talk about
this. I don't know if they haven't seen each other in 5 years.
They've never seen that kid before.
Yeah, I feel like
I don't know about that either.
Yeah, I don't think they have seen him. But like I said, he's basically offering his hospitality to them.
Sure.
And they're like, no, go fuck yourself. We only wanted your brain. And he's like, all right, bye.
Yeah.
It'd been cool if there was a scene where there's a kind of awkward silence, like, so this time travel thing? He's like, get out, all right.
Scott Lang would just be like, yeah, so like, Iron Man's so cool.
What about Hot Tub Time Machine?
So then they're like, well, we have a really big brain we could go talk to.
Yes.
And thank God. Again, another character who finally, I mean, they really do get him in, like,
well, do you
Ragnarok.
Know why this is, right?
Because he doesn't have a solo movie.
He doesn't have a solo movie, but do you know why?
Because they're setting up for Professor Hulk.
No, because Universal still actually owns the rights to any solo Hulk movie.
Still?
Oh,
I thought that was all
I thought that
done.
Was over.
No. Yeah.
Do they have a few more years on
or, it? I think it expires, like, now.
Oh, shit.
But,
well, that's okay.
But that's why we've basically gotten the arcs that we have with Hulk throughout other people's movies.
Which is so funny because, like, poor Hulk, he's not going to get a fucking movie now.
No. Like,
he might.
Well,
with, like, crippled arm?
Yeah, trying to, like, feeling, like, inadequate to his former self. He's like, man, I need to get back to my full strength.
That's him all the time in Infinity War. He's like, I need that Hulk Viagra. I love...
little green pill?
Yeah. Oh. I love... we'll just call him Professor Hulk. I love Professor Hulk. So, yeah, he's so fucking funny.
Okay, what's...
he's the last character you were expecting to become cocky.
Yeah. Okay, this is funny, too, because of this scene, he's extremely cocky and a little douchey.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But then that fades away almost instantly. It was just for this bit. But I'm totally forgiving of it.
No, I don't even know if it's just for the bit or if he's basically like, I've had nothing else going for me. Like, so I've had to take on this pseudo-celebrity.
Yeah.
And then now it's like, oh, shit, you guys, like, I am valued on the team. So that's what I think it is.
Well, because also...
also, he gets his confidence back through that.
It's a thing that you lose on the first viewing, right? Is his... because you're just so enamored with, one, how funny it is to see Mark Ruffalo talking through this... like CGI
no more
character.
Like,
right?
Yeah.
He's just like, hey, it's me, Mark Ruffalo. Right? So, like, you're kind of lost in that because the first time I saw it, I'm just laughing. He's not even saying anything funny, and I'm just like...
Hulk with glasses?
Yeah. Hulk with glasses
cardigan.
And a cardigan.
Yeah, he's like, yeah, no ripped clothes. I know. It's crazy.
Right?
I'm wearing shirts.
And
I'm wearing
so
shirts.
There's something that I kind of lost on first viewing and then gained back on the following ones is that when he goes, everybody lost, but I lost twice. Right?
Yeah.
And felt... deeply responsible, right? Which I didn't really connect to also why he takes on the snap responsibility even heavier than, like, it seems like in that moment of being like, oh, I'm going to die. It's like, because he thinks in his mind somewhere that he probably could have stopped Thanos on his own, where it's no, you couldn't, dude, but you won't let that go.
But he never got the chance to try.
He did.
To go round two. Round two. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. That's what I'm talking. It's like, he couldn't become the Hulk.
Right. So he never stopped the New York invasion in the beginning.
Yep.
Right. And then never stopped the end either.
Yep.
Yeah. So
he couldn't. He couldn't stop it. And he genuinely is like, fuck. Like, he was the biggest loser out of them because he had nothing to bring to the fight, basically.
Yeah.
He was worthless. It was Hawkeye.
Poor Hawkeye. He vaped at me. Yeah. So then some kids come up. One of the best.
Can I just
scenes.
Say, if somebody's listening out there and you're not following the Core Six on Instagram, you are missing out. They are so much fun to like follow their personal lives.
Tattoos.
They got tattoos.
I don't follow any of them.
No.
Oh, you should.
You're missing out. That's what I'm saying. Like, they're.
I'm not gonna follow Tom Holland though, because one day he's just gonna be like, oh yeah, by the way, Spider-Man gets his dick sucked, and I'm like, damn, dude, I was waiting for the next movie. And Mark Ruffalo spoils shit all the time too on accident.
Yeah. What's fun about following them is that, like, they're. Friendship. It's just like you were saying about the Jumanji cast.
Yeah.
Like, their friendship outside of that, and how much they on the press tour for Endgame, watching it, if you follow Hemsworth and you followed Renner, and they literally, as they're signing each, like, posters for
they were
people,
drawing mustaches.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I saw that. Which is, again, plays into with Thor Ragnarok and then Thor in this, is just that, like, goddamn, I'm so happy they figured out that Chris Hemsworth is actually really funny.
Yeah.
Because, like,
he's on my, like, top list of, like, celebrities that I would want to meet.
Because of him?
Point. He's fucking huge.
Yeah.
When I saw him. You were
there. I know the story, yeah.
Were you there, though, when they came
early
out?
Early in the morning.
Yeah. God damn, those guys are enormous. You walked by me, I was like, I am a manlet. It's like, Jesus Christ.
It just seems so much fun.
Yeah.
You know?
But because of him, I'm looking forward to Men in Black.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he's the only good part about Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
I didn't see that one.
He's excellent in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's about it. Him and Kate McKinnon.
Yeah,
that
Kate. I was going to say, there's someone else that's pretty good. And upon a
very ashamed second viewing,
Leslie Jones is pretty funny. The shit that they show you in the trailer from her is not funny, but the other stuff that she does in it, when she's like, she's when the monster's on her shoulders and she's like, I'm just gonna leave. And everyone's like, and she's like, nope. She's like walking out of there with that shit on her shoulders. I was like,
okay.
Yeah, that's a good one. No, yeah, he's very funny. Yep. But Mark Ruffalo is also hilarious in this scene when he fucking dabs. Yeah. That back and forth where, like, Ant-Man's like, hey, I'm Ant-Man, just really encompassing the, like, no one knows who the fuck you are. It's like, you fought in one thing with the Avengers, and then everything else was in San Francisco. Well,
and everything has been, like, very secretive. It's all been about heists and about you're tiny. Like, maybe people saw you in San Francisco, which you didn't see this one, but, like, he, like, saved a boat or something.
Yeah, he gets, like, big in the water. Yeah. It's like, yo, dude, you're almost a defender, so, like, no one knows who you are.
And at the same time, like, and when you have presented yourself to the world, nobody doesn't know that you're not a villain.
Yeah.
That was confusing, sorry, but...
Yeah. No, I just love, he's like, oh, you want a picture with me? I'm Ant-Man. They're like, he's like, okay, all right. And they're like, no, take a picture with him. Take a picture. He's like, no, like,
he wants a picture.
He wants a picture. And he's like, no, he's shaking his head. No. He's like, nah, come on, take a picture. Now he feels bad. Take a picture. He's like, take the goddamn phone.
Yeah. Like, there were so many moments in this where they finally were just like, you know what? The people that are watching this have all grown up with this. It's okay to cuss. Because that was another thing where I was like, he just said goddamn. Like,
yeah.
You know, like, which that's fine, you know, but in my mind where I'm like, I know at least in our screening today, we had at least 5 to 6 children with us. You
kicking
know?
My seat.
Here's a question for you now that you're talking about swearing. I was going to ask it later, but you brought it up. This movie's rated PG-13. which means it is allotted one fuck. Where would you put it?
Ooh. Oh, man.
I think I would put it when Thanos gets snapped, if he just looked down and was like, fuck.
That's a good question.
You can think about it.
Okay, okay, okay.
And if you come to it in the story, be like, right here.
Yeah, either
when he's like, get snapped, or about when his head's about to be chopped off, instead of saying, I'm an inevitable, he's like, fuck. It's like, shunk. Yes.
No, it's at the end where he's like, you want to tell me about her? He's like, we fucked.
You can't say that. That makes it R-rated.
Oh, okay.
It's the implication of the
like,
fuck.
Like, oh, fuck?
Oh, fuck, you could totally say it. Or like, fuck, but you can't say like, we fucked, because that's R-rated.
Because it's sex.
Yes, it's insinuating that it's sex.
Oh, okay, well, I'll get back to it then.
Yeah, but yes, the Hulk does say, go green.
It's great.
And then he dabs, and he goes, dab.
I would say
Hulk
let's
out.
Make
Hulk out.
I would say let's make t-shirts for all this, but it's probably already happened.
Oh, no, it's and Disney
the
will
time
come,
has passed.
They will bust this door down and kick her ass.
Give us all your shirts.
Give us your green.
Dab. Yeah, so basically he's like, yeah, sorry, this is out of my wheelhouse. And they're like, shit, why did we come to you?
Yeah.
Also, why are you eating 12 eggs?
Did you see the bowl of eggs?
Yeah.
It's huge.
Today was the day I saw it. I was like, god damn. He's eating like a whole bunch of sausage.
Yeah.
But he's like, but we can figure it out, essentially. So they go back to...
So now, as this is happening, Tony is debating whether or not he should figure this out, right?
He's like, should I figure it out? Well, I did, so...
These scenes, especially on a second watch, man. One, like, I don't know who is casting these little girls, because, Ant-Man's daughter, especially in the sequel, she is adorable, she is lovable, like, she's funny. Like, so, like, I don't know who's casting these children, right? But, like, this girl playing Morgan, Tony's daughter, is...
Give her an Oscar.
I am watching it and I'm just like, this was the thing I wanted to say to you. I was like, I'll hold it for the show. Is that like this little girl and their interaction, right, was the first time where I was like, if this is what it's like, I want to be a dad.
Told you.
Yeah.
It could be cool.
Right? In this one moment.
But
that's it.
I will say, I think she's pretty bad.
Really?
Yeah.
I think her performance, little kids are never that good when it comes to like, especially that young, because they just can't fully grasp the concept of acting. Mm-hmm. I don't think she's bad, but her performance does come off candid to me.
Okay.
Like very much like, this is just a kid. Like, that's, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, it's not acting.
I'll give you that one in the cheeseburger scene.
Yeah. Yes, because she's, like, fidgeting around in the cheeseburger
scene. He's like, you like cheeseburgers? She's like, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's when I was like, oh.
It's not emotional for her.
No. When
she's like, your dad likes cheeseburgers?
Because well, I don't
like,
think she fully...
My real dad?
Yeah, exactly. She's like, my dad's a vegetarian.
Yeah.
But I don't think, as young of an age, she didn't grasp death.
Yeah.
And who she just lost.
Okay, yeah, also, yeah, in that moment when she, like, she's viewing the hologram at the end.
Yeah, it's like, yo, she does not understand, and she will not remember you, Tony Stark. Goodbye.
Yeah. Yeah.
Pepper is gonna get a stepdad.
Tappy.
No, he's trying to bang
in
Peter's
the comic,
mom.
They do fall in love and get married.
I know, but he's trying to bone Peter's aunt.
I'm just saying.
She's hotter, though, so
yeah.
Good for him. Good for you, John Favreau. Shit. Make Chef 2.
I tried to do a My Cousin Vinny thing right there, and I'm sorry. I
make very bad things, too.
Okay.
He figures out time travel, which is just like... Why is everything so easy for him?
Like, it makes you feel dumber.
He's not even a genius. His computer just is.
Yeah.
It's just like,
he's like, apply Ohm's law and write a SSM3.
Can you open this and reverse it? And he's like, it's like complete. And he goes, oh, shit. And then that's a cute moment. She's like, shit. And he's like, oh, no, only mommy uses that word because she made it. The very cute moment. Jonathan's teary up moment. I love you 3000.
Yes. Love you 3000 is...
Whew. honestly, I think has a bigger impact on the second viewing because you know what it means throughout the movie.
Absolutely.
And you're like, this is the first time you hear it, and you're like,
I was a little like, damn, Tony.
Yep.
I see what you're dealing with.
And he's such a cool dad.
Yeah.
He is a cool
father. I'm gonna sell all your toys.
Yeah, and he's like, go to bed, I'm gonna sell all your toys. Right? It'll be me.
Tell me a story. Once upon a time, Morgan went to sleep. Good night.
I do that to Luz all the time. She's like, tell me a story. I'm like, once a time, there was a little girl that didn't go to bed. The end.
Wait. Your girlfriend makes you tell her a good night story?
Sometimes, yeah.
This is what happens when you're in a relationship, Jonathan.
Yeah, John.
God damn it. You too? Carly?
No, we just talk forever, and then all of a sudden it's like quiet, and you're like, oh, they're asleep. This is the story I tell Carly. God damn it, get the cat to stop playing in the blinds. So he goes downstairs, and he's like, hey, Pepper, what are you doing? She's like, oh, just reading an article about why you should put jade eggs in your pussy. That's one of her. That's a Gwyneth Paltrow shit. And he's like, oh, cool. Yeah. Anyway, I figured out time travel.
Yes.
That is the epitome of being like, hey, what's up? Anyway, so I did something cool.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. You did that? I discovered time travel.
Yeah. How's compost? Well, compost is, yeah, fuck off.
Yeah, that's worm shit. Anyway, time travel.
Yeah.
And she has a very interesting reaction because she is basically like, yeah, you know what you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, basically being like, yeah, but Morgan. And she's like, you know what you have to do. Yeah. She's like, millions died, or built trillions, as they say. It's like, yeah, you got a daughter, but, you know, a lot of people lost.
I think she's in the same realm, though. Like, it feels like she's in the same realm of how I said I was feeling, where I'm like, what does that mean for us? What does it mean if you could go back and get them? Because none of them really know.
Yeah, but I think she's still more along the lines of, like, you need to try and fix this if you can, at whatever cost.
You need to, or you're going to drive me crazy.
With great power comes great responsibility.
Shut up, Spider-Man.
Hey,
if you can't be Spider-Man without the suit, then stop. Then your girlfriend will go and be in Black Klansman. They're trying meanwhile at Avengers headquarters.
Yeah.
They're like, all right, let's do it.
Did we get Thor back yet?
No.
That's the Muppets movie where they get the gang back together.
No, because after Tony comes back, then they're like, you got the team? We're working on it.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. We're almost there.
Hour and a half later.
Yeah. They put Ant-Man through the time machine.
This is going to be as long as the movie, folks. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. We're going minute by minute.
Yeah. Maybe
a little slower. They put Ant-Man, and they're going to put him into the time machine.
This scene is hilarious.
It is funny. Yeah. I like that it doesn't work. I do laugh at this scene, and I do really like it. But for a movie that's really fucking long, it's a scene that I'm like, all right, I get it.
Like, okay.
You know what I mean?
I mean, I understand filler. Your point. Yeah.
Like, I know it's only a few seconds, but if you cut out adolescent Scott and just went baby and adult, or like baby and old man, and then we're like, all right, we're good. Yeah. I would be like, all right.
Nope, that's the rule of three again, man.
I guess.
The third one is him finishing. It's like, someone peed in my pants. I don't know if it was baby me.
Yeah, see, that's the third.
Me.
That's the punchline.
Yeah, I guess so.
Set up, punchline.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but I do like when he says, somebody beat their pants.
I understand from an audience standpoint of them thinking people weren't going to understand it. They needed adolescent one so that he could talk back and be like, yeah, it's me.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
But who else would it be? Random baby?
Do we
random
just pull
old
be?
Man?
It could be the fact that they're like, oh my God, we just pulled, I don't know, Hank Pym. I don't know. Like, you know, like.
Also, just going to throw this out here. This would have been the good time for the Stan Lee cameo.
Yes.
Old man.
Yes.
He'd be like, what? What's going on? And then boom, gone. Because his cameo in this movie is fucking weird.
The worst.
Yes. I would love to do like a mini episode where we just rank Stan Lee's cameos.
Oh, the best. My favorite one is still from a shitty movie, Amazing Captain Spider-Man, when he's in the, when he's just there, and then they're like, he's like cleaning
oh,
shit.
Oh,
they're
like in the library. Yeah. That one's a good one.
Yeah, that's awesome. One of my favorite. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it's a terrible movie.
Oh, yeah, that's all right.
Is that the first one or the second one?
First one.
No, it's the lizard.
Yeah.
I love the Captain Marvel one. One, Kevin Smith, of course.
When he's reading Mallrats.
Right.
Yeah.
But two, I love it because it nails it. It confuses it. It gets super meta because basically now it's the creator of Marvel movies who has written, you know, Marvel comics and is now reading a script for something in which he will play himself.
Yeah.
It's super, it gets weird because you're wait. So now this guy, we're talking about the real Stan Lee, is now in the Marvel universe that he created.
Yeah, that's a bit weird.
It gets way weird when you think
a
about
rift
it.
Starts opening, he's like, ah! I do, there was a video I was watching about, things that people didn't realize the implications of them, and that one where he's out in space talking to those aliens.
With the Watchers?
Oh, yeah, because people got way weird on that.
They were like what theories? The fuck is he doing there? It's just like, it was like, oh, it was supposed to be funny, but they didn't understand that. They straight up opened a can of worms on that one. Mm-hmm. They were like, oops.
You mean yeah. Stan Lee is watching over all of us?
But it's also, what was the Watchers thing was like, they accidentally did something way ahead in the continuity too early was basically what people were upset about with that one was like, the Watchers thing shouldn't have happened yet, basically.
The Watchers are always watching. They can't interfere with time.
Yeah.
Until, like, there's an event in the comics, at least.
Until there's an HBO series.
Yeah, right.
Yes, the Watchmen. Oh, yeah, do it. I like watching men.
You shit your pants if that was the show.
Yeah. So, they're like, damn, time travel doesn't work. So, they, Captain America goes outside and he hears a car screeching and pulls up
in a brand new 2020 Audi.
The second e-tron. One we've seen in this movie.
Fully featured. 45 miles to the gallon.
At like a sales angle.
Yes. Oh, this yeah. is literally, this one shot of this car is almost as gratuitous as all of the Mercedes shots in Jurassic Park Lost World.
Or every car in Transformers.
Yeah. Right. When all the cast was going to the premiere for the movie in Hollywood, they were all like, thanks so much, hashtag Audi, for dropping me off at the hashtag Avengers Endgame premiere. I love my hashtag Audi. It's like, I was like, is Audi in this movie? And then they showed up. I was like, fuck.
Yeah, they are.
And he's like, also, just throwing this out there, Audis are luxury cars. They are really nice, but Tony Stark would drive something way more bougie.
He's been driving it since the first movie.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right, because they sponsor the movies.
Yeah. Remember
what if he
in
showed
the
up
second
in a
one?
DeLorean?
Nice.
Whoa.
Remember in the second one when he had like the full scale like Stark Expo model like in out of the driver's passenger
yes,
seat?
Yes, yes.
Just driving down the PCH.
So basically Tony,
they make amends.
Tony shows up and he's like, time travel didn't work, huh? It's like, listen, you're an asshole. It's like, yeah, you push time through him. It's like, God, you know, Tony, you son of a bitch. I'm getting really sick of you being right. Yeah, he gives him his shield. He says, don't lose this one because, like, you know, I don't have any more, basically.
Yeah.
And then he's also like,
how did he lose the last one? Did he break it in Civil War?
No, Tony took it. In Civil War, he's like, Tony, as, you know, defeated, he's like, you can't take that shield. That doesn't belong to you.
Yeah. Wow. And then, I still wish he had those badass fists, but okay. And then he's like, also, like, keep it on the down low, because I didn't bring enough for everyone else. It's just like, by the way, you're my favorite.
Funny.
I love you.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for being so mean.
Right? And so he's basically like, so we're going to need a team. You got a team? And they're like, we're working on this, right? And this is where Ant-Man goes out to eat a taco.
That scene's pretty great. Yes, he's eating a taco, and a ship just fucking lands and blows everything out of the taco. And that's straight up a Taco Bell taco without the
wrapper.
That's
the double. Oh, yeah. That's the new double wide one.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
It shows up better on camera.
You know what's great about it being blown out of the taco? He never got a chance to eat it, which means people wouldn't be like, what the fuck? Why is he eating his taco like that, regardless of how he ate it?
Yeah, that's true.
You should have ate it top down, and then it blew out. And they'd be like, that's the universe telling you not to.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's Nebula and Rocket mm-hmm. show back up. Mm-hmm. And she, what did she say?
Rhodey watched Landing. There's a moron in Landing Bay.
Yeah, like, why is everybody picking on yeah, somebody they've so never met before?
I personally, that line is like, damn, that's mean. I think it would have been funnier if she was like, Rhodey, be careful. There's a homeless man in the landing area. Like, that would have been funny. Rhodey lands and scares the shit out of him. He's like, what's up, tiny man?
It's like, average size man.
Yeah, normal size man.
Yeah, and it's like, why is everyone dogging on Ant-Man? He's literally going to save your guys' life with his idea.
Yeah.
And then Hulk comes out. And this is when I realized, oh, shit. Nobody made Hulk shoes? Because this is the second time I watched it, I was like, he's fucking barefoot.
Yeah.
Poor guy.
He's a hipster, man.
Yeah. Hulk out.
Yeah.
Hulk out.
So Hulk and Rocket go and travel to New Asgard.
Yes, which is where, as I watched Ragnarok again the other day, is the same place where he goes and sees Odin, and Odin's like, remember this place.
Oh, okay.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Wow.
That you can see it up on the hill, the flowers on the thing. That's where he died.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Did not know that.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Yeah, and so they're there in some fucking place.
Like the Netherlands.
Yeah,
or
like
something.
Norway.
Yeah.
I always thought it looked Irish.
It does look very Irish, but a lot of that shit up there does. So
shit, a lot of that shit.
Those are my people.
Yeah,
so it's good.
It's all our peoples.
But yeah, so it's like a Scandinavian country.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I love Valkyrie as a character. I love how she really like came into herself as a character. She's just like,
she just needs more movies.
She
and
needs
room
a,
to grow.
She yeah. needs a movie.
Next Thor movie will be.
No, I think they need to go back and do a fucking Valkyrie movie.
A Valkyrie movie?
That'd be rad.
Sure.
Those horses.
I'm down.
Those horses?
Yeah, like the Pegasus.
The
yeah.
Pegasi?
Yeah. But yeah, she's like, they're like, hey, where's Thor?
They're all like fishermen now.
Yeah, and she's like, which is so funny, it's like they basically just became Scandinavians. they're like, where's Thor? And they're like, shit, we don't ever see him unless he's coming down to get fucked up. Shit.
Yeah, so they go to his house, and Thor lives with Korg.
Korg and
Reek?
I always forget his Meek. Yeah.
Meek.
And he's like, oh, are you the cable guy? Cable's been going out.
And so Thor is revealed to have been completely depressed. His hair and his beard have completely grown past the point we've ever seen it before, even.
And he actually hangs himself in this scene.
It got dark real quick.
Yeah, they got to him very late.
And he has a gigantic beer belly.
Which is fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
This is the best thing.
It's because he has gone through, like, I'm just going to say it. Like, Thor 1, you're like, damn, he's handsome. And, like, Thor 2, same shit. And then you're like, Ragnarok, you're like, fuck, this guy's hot. And then now you're like, oh shit.
I totally believe that that this was at least 50% his idea.
Oh, it was.
He watched season 5 of It's Always Sunny and was like, I should get fat.
No, because
season 5.
Which one is it?
It's like 9.
It's not that far in.
It's 7 or 9.
Fat Mac?
Yeah. It's not 5. I know it's not 5, because season 5 is with the waitress gets married.
Oh, you right.
Yeah.
But anyway. Yes, but he does get fat.
And it is his idea, because he was getting bored of the character, so he's like, oh, I want to change it up. So like in Ragnarok, they cut his hair and everything, and this one,
that was a great choice.
Oh,
I'm really actually upset that he's gone back to long hair.
Yeah, no, yeah. My mom was so funny. She saw the poster and she's like in love with him. And
yeah.
She was like, the Ragnarok poster. She's like, I just really liked him with that long hair. And then she saw Ragnarok. She's like, I really like that that short hair on him. And I was like, it looks great.
So what'd she say about Fat Thor?
She hasn't seen it yet. They're seeing it tomorrow.
Oh, oh. Shit.
Yeah,
I can't wait to hear this.
Yeah.
No!
By the way, it's season 6.
Is it 6?
Yes.
Damn. Okay, but, in between.
Yeah. No, but the funny thing about, like, yeah, Big Thor, is he's like, reminds me of my dad. He's just like, like, I love it.
I just want to drink a beer. Goddamn DCA.
Yeah, and... Holy shit, everyone knew it was gonna happen, but I don't think anyone really thought they were gonna do it. They're playing fucking Fortnite.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Korg.
That's like two strong millennial references within like 5 to 10 minutes of itself.
Yeah.
Dabs and that.
Yeah, Korg. Thor is basically Korg's dad now. And he's like, Thor, there he is back on the screen.
Noob Slayer 69.
Noob Master 69.
Listen here, Noob Master.
He fucking roasts some child.
What's funny is, like, if you heard it from anyone else, you'd be like, oh, yeah, you're going to come get me? But you're like, oh, shit, Thor said he's going to fly to my house and fuck me up.
And it's also so funny because it's like, yo, he has nothing to lose. He is going to come to my house and fuck me up.
Oh, it'd be funny if you had it on all over the microphones here. Yeah, you're going to miss Thanos' head again?
yeah, you going to fuck me up like you did Thanos?
But then again, I like... See, this is how I feel the moments should have been done, is laugh first, make you sad second, because it makes it so much more impactful when they're just like, hey, man, Thanos, and he's just like,
that's how they did it.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying this moment.
Oh,
is,
this moment did
this
it
moment
right.
Did it right. Whereas everything else is like, sad, oh, yeah, laugh, yeah. Please laugh. Like, yeah, we don't want you to be sad. This one was like, oh, Jesus Christ.
I mean, it does wrap it up with, there's beer.
Yeah, which is like, good. It's a good sandwich of the jokes, but it's like, that
you're not
makes...
supposed to sandwich people.
Oh, my God. That, it makes the whole, like, punch of them being like, we're gonna go get Thanos. And he's like,
I fuck. Love this moment when he says Thanos, right? And he grabs him by the collar, right? And Hulk is straight up, like, the expression. It's all about the expression in his face where, like, he's letting him go through the process, right? But his face is like, come on, dude. You know?
No, like, no, do you know what? On this viewing, I was like, fuck, man, this is so sad. Thor's straight up pathetic. Is when Hulk says to me, he's like, take your hand off of me.
Yeah.
He's like, just take your hand off of me.
Yeah.
And it's like, damn, Thor, you're lame as fuck now. Yeah. Like, everyone's just like, they feel so bad for you. But yeah, and then he's like, that really bums me out when he sits down in that chair and he's like, I'm fine.
Yeah.
I'm fine.
It's just denial.
I don't need anything.
It's part of depression.
I know, but it's so sad because I love Thor now.
No, his arc is really good in this, and we'll get to that when we get to the mom stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want to go there.
So they basically convince him to join the team by saying there's beer on the ship and just come and do this.
Yeah, and they're like,
yeah.
They're like, then Ant-Man's like, why didn't you guys put me in the joining the team montage? And they cut through like, hey, Ant-Man, we're getting the gang back together. He's like, okay. That was a Muppet movie reference to when Rolf is like, why didn't you guys put me in the montage? And he's just laying there in a hammock and they're like, come on. Do you want to join? He's like, okay. That's it.
Yeah.
And then finally, I mean, we don't know who it is, but they go to Tokyo. And there's this dude just fucking the Yakuza.
I feel like there's a movie here that we will see or should have seen.
I think
a
we're
show
gonna...
or an episode.
Yeah, it's like a show. Yes. Yeah. Well, here's the problem, and this is what's funny about this. Because you know the comics. Yeah. Hawkeye becomes Ronin.
Right.
But because we have intersected all comic books with these films, we have a character named Ronin they've already encountered. So they were like, shit, we can't call him Ronin because everyone's going to
be confused.
We'll
just not say anything.
Yeah, they're just gonna be like, Clint, what the fuck?
What are you doing, man?
You're a murdering maniac. And then, like I was about to say, holy shit, finally, he's fucking cool.
Yeah.
It's just like, he's got a bitchin' sword. He's not really using arrows at this point.
No.
Nope. And he's just fucking dudes.
Which I don't
up.
Understand why he's not, though. Because like,
he's cool as shit.
Why isn't it a combo?
Ninja stars or something.
He does have ninja stars. He does hit a dude like... And he kills a Yakuza boss. And then Natasha just watches him murder a man.
She just lets it happen. Yeah.
Well, I think he's like, when the guy's like, help me, I think he's talking to her.
He is. He's talking to her because he can see her. He's like, please help me. And she's just like, nah, it's cool. I got to let him get this out or he'll kill me.
Yeah.
He needs to get this one out.
This is, again, any scene that has Hawkeye in it and Black Widow for some reason has this uncomfortable sexual tension because they're just standing there. She touches his hand. I was like, I don't know what happened on that plane ride home, but
autopilot was engaged.
Nice.
Elon Musk. You see that tweet from him recently?
No.
It's like, I should have known this was going to happen with autopilot.
And he's like, oh, the sex
I should have known because there was a porno
video.
Watch it?
No. I watched it. It was a redhead. What do you want?
Oh my God. So on brand for you. Yeah, so they get the gang back, and they're basically, like, trying to figure out. They're like, hey, here's the stones. This is what we're going to do.
It's a cool, like, planning of the heist thing.
Yeah. They're also trying to figure out, like, oh, wait, is this before? This is where I get confused right now.
What?
When does Hawkeye test the thing? Is it after they explain the time heist, or is it before?
Before.
Doesn't really matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Okay, so they're explaining the time heist, basically what they're going to do. Because the gang's back together.
Oh, no, they do test the machine before they start putting in the... They're like, oh, we know that this works. Now what's the plan? You're right.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
So, yes. Clint... Well, first it was supposed to be Ant-Man.
Well, Ant-Man wastes one. While they're doing the whole time travel...
And then he's like, you're going to Hulk this up, right?
Yeah, they really... this is where all the time travel jokes come from.
Yeah.
He's like... All right, it's easy. We just don't talk to our past selves. We don't, like, interfere with anything.
So I'm glad we got into this, because this got confusing on my first watch.
I pretty much
like,
was
the
like,
explanation.
Okay.
The second time, I was like, I follow it better.
Well, so this is... I really like time travel movies outside of, like, Back to the Future.
Safety not
No,
guaranteed.
No, I mean, I love Back to the Future.
Okay.
I'm saying... That's like, always everyone's quintessential.
I was like, I think this podcast is over.
That's always everyone's quintessential, but it raises more questions than it answers.
Oh, of course.
Type thing.
Oh, yeah.
So this movie finally is like the first movie I've seen in a long time that explained to you how most time travel in movies works.
Or actually doesn't work.
Or doesn't work. Because the one that I keep going back to is like, okay. Then Looper, like, it worked.
Looper doesn't make any goddamn sense.
Looper doesn't make any sense, but it's also like, well, now everyone under... So when they said your future reality can't become your current reality from your past reality, it's like, oh, that's why everyone still remembers shit after time traveling. There we go.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, it took us to 2019 for a superhero movie to explain time travel properly?
No, you know the movie gets a lot of shit for just being what it is, but the one that I've always praised...
Wrinkle in Time.
Oprah. Yeah. No, Terminator 3.
Yep.
Okay, because like basically they're like, we stopped Judgment Day. He's like, you only like
delayed it.
Yeah. You can't stop it or else the other two movies wouldn't exist.
Yeah,
you know. And I was like, bravo, rest of shitty movie.
Yeah, they were like, no, that ending of that movie is fucking dark too.
Yeah, it is.
Cuz
it's
just
good.
Like, oops.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it's gonna happen.
Yeah. No, yeah, this movie
TX just sucks.
Oh, the sexy robot?
Yeah. I was like, why would you, like, downgrade, in my opinion, from, like, fully liquid metal to liquid metal over an endoskeleton?
No, yeah. Also, why would you even think about making a villain for the third one when the second's villain is so fucking cool?
Yeah. Like, you can't beat it.
Yeah. No, yeah, so this is, time travel, it explains it so well. It's like, oh, so they don't have to worry about any of this shit. However, it does bring up one question in a scene we're going to get to.
That's also why Genesis is good. Because it just creates a different reality in 1984. Like regular 1984 that we saw in the first Terminator works. And then when they sent something back to 70s instead, it just fractured off into another one. So actually, if you still watch them in order of release, it still completely makes sense.
I was going to make a Genesis joke, like the band, but for the life of me, couldn't remember a fucking song. Like, Genesis is really good. I love... Insert song here.
I can feel it coming in the air tonight.
I was like, is that Genesis or is that What's his
It's Phil Collins.
It's
Phil
Collins. Genesis. No, yeah. Genesis is Genesis. Oh. The band. Phil Collins is Phil Collins.
Studio.
Isn't that... is that them?
That's Genesis.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah.
I wanna know. Can you show me? Why are you singing like that?
Because it's Schwarzenegger. Oh, wow.
I was like, Phil Collins does not sound like that. He's not Austrian.
It took you that long.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know what he was doing either.
Thank you.
I was like, okay.
I was like, you okay?
Terminator Genesis.
You having a fucking stroke?
You know what Phil Collins sounds like, right?
He doesn't sound like that. That's for fucking sure. Yes, so they're basically, this is another great joke, they're like, no, like, you don't have to, you can do whatever you want, because your past self can't become your current self, because then that would mean your current self right now is your past self. And he's like, you mean hot time machine?
Yeah.
Like, you mean Back to the Future is bullshit? I was like, I love you, Scott Lang.
I mean, it really is when you think about it.
But it's funny that they said that, because they're basically speaking for the audience to be like, everything you thought that they were going to have to do, don't worry about that, because that's bullshit in this situation.
Yeah.
Don't, like, you're fine. You're good. Like, there you go. We laid it for you. So no one.
And even if you didn't understand it, we'll have the Sorcerer Supreme give you a little bit more.
Yeah. Yeah. Basically just being like, we better not see any videos on YouTube after long release of why the time travel just doesn't work. It's like,
that's true. You haven't seen one, have you? Damn right.
No.
So, now they basically prove that, and Clint is like, I will take the risk and I'll go back in time. Like, he's taking risks in this movie.
He just
constantly
wants to fucking die.
Yeah, he really does.
Like,
which
I genuinely
is really
think
good.
He's just like, please just let me die, because I've done some bad shit and I have nothing to live
because
for.
I also don't think that he truly believes any of this will work.
No,
I
think
don't
he's
think so.
Lost.
Not until it actually happens do I think
right.
it,
he's
like,
jaded as fuck.
I mean,
yeah.
And that's another thing that I love about his character in this movie, finally, is like, before he was like not even a Mary Sue. He was just like, who the fuck are you? You're just the Arrow guy.
You're just the guy that we needed to possess in the first movie.
You just can't hear. Get out of here.
Yeah, so he goes back in time to an unknown time, but basically where...
his kids
he's
are
back
still
to the
alive.
Farm. Okay, this is my question about this time travel thing, is that, like, Tony does say it's a time travel GPS, but I'm like, GPS in time or GPS also in location?
Both.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
the
this
no, the
raises
GPS,
a question.
Yeah.
Okay.
They place travel too.
Right.
Yeah.
Right? So well, they're not just showing up in upstate New York in 2012, right? They're literally jumping to the spot where they want to be as well,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
Which makes me go, why did they all show up on Morag and then take a ship to the Soulstone planet? Couldn't they just show up on the Soulstone planet?
Well, they had to drop them. I guess, like, why didn't they split off into two?
Yeah.
Like,
there was no need
teams?
For four of them to show up on Morag and then take a ship to go.
Yeah.
You just show up where you want to show up.
Oh, no, she said it because the coordinates for the Soulstone planet were a moving target. It was a moving coordinate.
Really?
Yeah.
I missed that one.
She says
wow,
she says the Soulstone planet is on a moving coordinate, so they should be able to find it. They basically gave him a rough place of where it will be, and then they find it.
And then when you land, you'll have to find that too.
That was
a big I was like, how the fuck did you find it so quickly?
Yeah.
What if you landed on the other side of the planet? You're like, what am I looking for?
Yeah.
Or what if it just took them years to find
also,
it?
Also, they parked fucking far away.
So I got a primo spot.
Yeah, all in this water, this reflective space water.
Yeah. They explain where they're going to get the stones. And basically...
Oh, yeah, but Clint went back in time real quick.
Saw his daughter.
Grabbed a baseball glove to prove that he could bring things back. And
which I noticed today. I was like, oh, I didn't notice he had the baseball glove to be
with.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which I think was... the goal as well. He's like, you got to bring something back. You got to prove that. You
what if he brought his daughter back?
Oh,
and
shit.
She came out all fucked up.
And she's like, I'm the new Hawkeye.
She comes out like the Fly, because a Fly came with him too.
We didn't say you bring back living beings.
Kill me. yeah, so he does it, and he's like, I did it. And they're like, all right, well, time to figure out these stones.
The heist, yeah.
Which is a great, because Thor,
good montage.
God damn it, Thor, fucking dead in that corner.
Is he asleep? No, I think he's dead.
Yeah. And then he's like, all right. So which stone is it?
This is the reality.
Reality stone. He's like, well, it's not really a stone as much as it's like, what does he say? Like a
liquid goo.
Here's another question. How did they convert the goo in Rocket's vial to a stone again?
Magic.
Don't magic me.
It just,
not explained.
I don't know.
Maybe, it's good to say I don't know. Well,
maybe
that's
it's
fine.
Just a liquid when it's in a person.
I could.
No, because it's a liquid in the vial of Rocket's vial.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe it's more of like pressure, like a diamond, where like you just mash
it. You just put it in an asshole and you squeeze it hard enough.
I made the stone.
No, it's what's in my bladder.
Damn. Jonathan can't pee corner. Yeah, so he just explains.
These poor people that have to listen to that joke every week.
It's a pretty funny explanation.
People and then start donating to my cause.
GoFundMe.
Those pills cost $216, folks. Give me money.
And then my mom, she died. And the Dark Elves, they were like...
And the Hulk's like, no.
Yeah, he's like, the Dark Elves, they're pretty scary.
I love how Scott is the only one fascinated with the story.
Yeah, he's sitting there just like, uh-huh, yeah.
Because
again, like I said, he is our lens.
He hasn't experienced almost anything that we have.
Yes.
But as an audience. But he is still, we've all experienced it, so we're on the same wavelength as the people in the room, because we're like, yeah, we know this. But at the same time, he is us, because he's straight up just human. So like, when they're telling him this shit about like Asgard, he's just like, uh-huh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's really cool to him.
Yeah, because he's like, oh shit, I didn't even know. He was like, he's probably just wilding out that there's a talking raccoon in the room.
Yeah, right?
And a literal god. Like,
yeah,
that's,
right?
Yeah, he's like,
I think that would be like...
Well, because he's fanboying out in this room.
Yeah, he's just like, holy shit, these people are cool as fuck. I'm just a thief. He's like, what's Natalie Portman's character's name?
Jane,
old flame of mine. It's just like that. That's when Hulk's like, "Yo, cut it." Like, all right, thank you, buddy. He's like,
old flame
"I'm not
of mine.
Done."
Oh, that there she is.
Yeah. Basically, it went into it and it made her very sick. I had to take her to Asgard. God, and then the Dark Elves, spooky. It's just like, yeah, and then they're talking about what's the next stone on the list? Then they talk about the Power Stone, which Quill got.
Uh-huh.
And they're like, we just need to go to this place to get that.
In space. Oh, a little space dog?
Yeah.
Wanna go space?
And then
they talk about the soul one.
Oh, and they're like,
that's the not it thing.
Yeah. What did you just say? They're sitting there and he's like,
not it.
Okay, so might as well get it out of the way now, too, is so you send your least powerful two to the thing that you know least about?
I'm actually going to go ahead and rebut that. Nat is Captain America, but Russian. She has a form of the Super Soldier Serum in her.
No, she doesn't.
Yeah.
Not in this continuity.
Oh, shit. Yeah, that's the comic book.
In the comics, maybe.
Yeah. But she's, like, super trained, so she's a lot better than Hawkeye. So, even as Ronin. But no, she,
No, but, like...
Yeah.
No, you send somebody who could deal with, like... You don't know what that is. You don't know what this planet is.
Well, that's...
All they know
the
is that
unknown.
Gamora, it died there.
You know what, though? That's probably why they sent the two of them. Because they're like, this
fuck
is easy peasy. You just show the fuck up and you get it. You know?
Oh, yeah. It could be.
I would have sent Nebula there at least.
Die like your sister.
Well, no, just the fact that, like, she is used to space things.
No, but she has to go to Morag because she's the one who was there when Quill was there. She knows where to go.
No, she wasn't.
Yeah, they show up.
She wasn't there.
Oh, that's right. They were in the vicinity or some bullshit.
Yeah,
they're
in a galaxy.
Yeah,
she
was
in that galaxy.
Well, the thing that like is insane to me is when they're all laying their brainstorming about where to get the other three, and then she's just like, if we go to the right place in time, all three of these are in the same place. And it's like, this is where you could throw your one fuck for the movie when Hulk's like, shut the front door.
Yeah, shut the fuck up. But at the same time, okay, this is weird for me, right? Because it almost seems like this whole, like, oh, if you pick the right year, you can go to the same place, right? But it's like, but why? Like, you can literally go anywhere you want.
Because everyone only
why
has...
Why not make it easier?
Because everyone only has a round trip.
Yeah.
And then
one round trip, and they have to make sure that where they go is, it is there. They can be like, well, it wasn't this facility maybe at this time?
Yeah. So, like, literally, we know that the Tesseract, like, was in their hands for, like, 2 days after that before... Or just fucking go to Asgard at the same time and go there when it's in the vault. The Tesseract's in the vault. Make it easier on yourself. Some of these things were written just so we could have an action sequence. Like, cool stuff. I'm not going to lie. And that's fine. I'm just saying, like, if we're talking about, like, real logic here, it's like, no, you would... Why not go get the scepter, I don't know, when it's sitting on the table before it becomes Ultron?
There you go. Like, talk you know? Tony talks to himself, like, hey, I need that.
Yeah, we're literally overnight where he's like, hey, Jarvis, why don't you, like, deal with this Mind Stone, and then it becomes Ultron? Literally go there as he turns out the light and be like, no, fuck that.
No, it's because...
Or bring Ultron.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, this is a... It does make sense. It's a pretty big deal, though. They just wanted you to forget that Age of Ultron happened.
Yeah. Or like, Captain America knows where the Tesseract was during the entire, like, final act, at least, of
his first movie.
Yeah.
You know what,
just
though?
Straight up show up to Red Skull's fortress with Iron Man, blow that shit to hell. Right?
But you know what?
This. Thanks, bye.
Yeah.
They're also, even though they can't affect anything tremendously, they're still choosing safe choices where they know the outcome of everything that occurs.
Sure.
So, like, that's why they're like, New York, we know what the fuck's going on there.
Yeah.
And the reason why they're going to New York, where in the Time Stone, let's just put it like this. If the Tesseract and the Time Stone were in the same place at the same time, and then one other one was there too, just by chance, you're going to go for that. Right? Two out of three would be a goal for
that. I hear that, and they can help each other out.
But here's the thing. With knowing Doctor Strange as what he is, like they thought they were going to do, he's the only one who's going to comprehend if they fucking show up and are like, yo, we need the stone.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm thinking.
That was also a gamble that they, like, he would even be there. What if he lived in San Francisco that year, like in my summer house?
Yeah,
what I have a problem with is, like, when they go to Morag, super easy. Let's just steal it right there, right? They picked the easy out there. It wasn't like they showed up to the end battle of Ronin.
Yeah,
Or, like, plucked it from the Nova Corps.
You know?
Yeah.
But
I know they just knocked Peter Quill the fuck out.
Just took it from him. And that's what I mean, where it's like, I'm totally grateful for what I got, because I'm like, these are great scenes that we're going to talk about. But at the same time, I'm like, you picked some shit just so we could have a, like, fanboy moment.
It's okay. Yeah. It was fun.
They should release...
I did. Literally, when that title card hits of 2012 and the, like, the beam into the sky, I was like... I fanboyed the fuck out, because I'm like, you are taking me back to things that I experienced 6 years ago as a person.
Yeah.
I was giddy as hell.
They should release alternate versions of these movies and, like, have, like, Captain America in the background, like, running around with a scepter or something. You're like, oh, there he is right there.
There he is.
But it wouldn't be in that one. If you're still watching it chronologically, that's what Hulk was talking about, where, like, that only is in a future, like, version of the same past.
Alternate takes now.
Of the old movie. You'd see him, like, running in the background, like, oh, gotta go.
Because now,
I mean, it'd be funny.
That'd be funny, yeah.
No, but that's not, like, if you were watching Avengers for the first time, you'd be like, that's not a real thing.
Yes.
Yeah, because it didn't happen. Yeah.
Yes.
So, yet. Yeah.
Yes.
So, they go on the time heist.
Well, now that we have you on the edge of your seat with that cliffhanger from part two of Avengers Endgame, get ready next week as we finish up the exciting climax and the finale of Avengers Endgame and what is also the exciting climax and finale of Phase 3 of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. All coming next week on the show. In the meantime, make sure you hit that like button, smash that like button, Hulk smash that like button, because we need your support. We need you to share this episode. Everybody in the world has seen this, so make sure that they listen to our review. Share it with your friends, share it with your family, share it on your wall feed, share it in your Instagram. Share, share, share. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week with the exciting conclusion of Avengers Endgame.
Excelsior!